What are you reading?
Hi, it's the Holy Quran.
But isn't the Quran only for Muslims?
Not at all. Its teachings are addressed to all humanity, from heads of state to everyday people like us.
What does it teach us?
It's a book of life for life. No thinking person should pass through life without it.
Where can I get a copy?
From the IPCI, 124 Queen Street, Durban.
Assalamu alaikum. I call on Maulana Qari Hafiz Faizur Rahman of Pakistan, presently based at Darul Uloom Chatsworth, Unit 7, to recite the Qur'an. Jazakallah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن ألم تر أنا أرسلنا الشياطين على الكافرين ألم تر أنا أرسلنا الشياطين على الكافرين تؤزهم أزا فلا تعجل عليهم يوم نحشر المتقين إلى الرحمن وفدا ونسوق المجرمين يوم نحشر المجرمين لقد جئتم شيئا إدا تكاد السماوات يتفطرن منه الأرض وتخر الجبال يتفطرن منه وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلرَّحْمَنِ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَ وَلَدًا وَمَا صدق الله العظيم وبلغنا رسوله النبي رؤوف رحيم
ما شاء الله جزاك الله مولانا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم I seek refuge in Allah from the rejected Satan and I begin in the name
of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Respected ulama, respected elders, brothers and sisters, it is a privilege for me to welcome you and to introduce to you our chairman for today, a promising and successful young man. In fact, Islam requires us to be successful. 5 times a day in the azan, the call to prayer, Allah reminds us to come to prayer, come to success. And this successful young man is Muhammad Salim Khan. He is a lawyer, an academic, and a lecturer at the University of Durban-Westville. His faculty is law. Brothers and sisters, I'd like you to meet our chairman, Brother Muhammad Salim Khan. Brother Salim.
Thank you. Peace be upon you and the mercy of God. This, translated into Arabic, reads, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ladies and gentlemen, that this symposium is God-ordained is indisputable by all those who believe in God. This begs the question, why are we present here? Why is it that of the millions of people in this world, you in particular, have been destined to attend this symposium? The definite answer to that question rests with Allah alone. However, this does not preclude us from questioning, from inquiring, in order to establish the purpose of your attendance here this afternoon. For it is only through serious inquiry, positive questioning, can one aspire to enlightenment and thence appreciate the greatness of our Creator. To my mind, ladies and gentlemen, and I submit this respectfully, we are here this afternoon to be educated and possibly to educate. The path to education is one paved with humility. In order to aspire to any great heights in education, in any facet or in any sphere, one must be able to acquire certain characteristics. Firstly, one must be able to shed off the bondage of skepticism. One must be able to shed off the bonds of subjectivity. One must be able to analyze issues objectively. Ladies and gentlemen, that objectivity is important, is trite. However, immaterial how compelling an argument is. If a person does not want to accept, if he does not want to accept a conversion of his ideas or beliefs, he will not be converted. For Allah clearly indicates in the Holy Quran that it is for him to convert ideas, it is for him to convert ideals. I'm not suggesting, ladies and gentlemen, that one should reject or abandon one's innate beliefs. What I'm merely submitting is that one should not allow one's innate beliefs and one's subjectivity to prevent one from analyzing someone else's belief, from analyzing someone else's argument, even if ultimately it resulted in the rejection of this other person's argument. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a gathering, a symposium of goodwill. It is a coming together of different religions, Islam, Christianity, and possibly aspects relating to Judaism. That these religions are similar begs of no doubt. They are like peas in the same pod, yet they are characterized by certain differences. It is hoped that in symposiums of this nature, in conferences and in discussions, there will be a resolve effectuated to these differences. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasant task of being chairman this afternoon. It is indeed our privilege to have with us this afternoon our very own Mr. Ahmed Didat, an eminent scholar of religion, a person who is responsible for a number of publications, an author of publications, a person of international repute, one who has especially in recent days acquired great renown. It is also our privilege to have a visitor from Canada who will be introduced to yourselves in due course. He too is a very prominent personality, one whose reputation precedes him, and we shall have the benefit of his knowledge this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, I present Mr. Ahmed Didat.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and blessings of God be upon you all. Mr. Chairman and brethren, Bodley, B-O-D-L-E-Y, Bodley, the American, in his book, The Messenger, he gives the relative strength of two of the mightiest religious forces on earth today, those of Islam and Christianity. He doesn't give us figures. He does not tell us that the Muslims today number 1,000 million and the Christians 1,200 million. But what he says is that these Muslims and Christians who are competing for the allegiance of mankind, that they, he says, that there are more professing Christians in the world than professing Muslims. Meaning that the number of people who tick off on census forms as Christians, there will be more of that than those who tick themselves off as Muslims. That there are more professing Christians in the world than professing Muslims. But, he says, there are more practicing Muslims in the world than practicing Christians. If I said this on my own account, blowing my own trumpet, would not have carried much weight. It makes me happy to quote an outsider, an American and a Christian at that. What is really the difference between Islam and Christianity? I may share with you that Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes it an article of faith for its followers to believe in Jesus. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus. What he is made to believe is that Jesus Christ was one of the mightiest messengers of God. He is made to believe that he was the Messiah. He is made to believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern day Christians do not believe today. And he is made to believe, the Muslim is made to believe, that Jesus Christ, he gave life to the dead by God's permission, and he healed those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. He gets all this from his book of authority, the Holy Quran. It is your privilege to get one. The NYM bookstall in the corner there, they are selling them for 5 rands each. 2,000 pages, an encyclopedia of 2,000 pages for 5 rands each. You will agree with me, this is very, very cheap. And if you can't afford it, Muslim as well as non-Muslim, you can write to the Islamic Propagation Center and tell us that, look, I'm earning 500 rands a month, but I can't afford a Quran, and you will get one by return post. Tell us why we should give you one for nothing. I'm not talking about the cultists, the born-again missionary. Look, he must pay for it, as we have to pay for the Bibles from the Bible house. But I'm talking about the general public. If you are interested in knowing the Quran, and if you can't afford it, write for one and get one free. Now, the points of real difference, what are the only points of real differences between the Muslim and the Christian is this, are these. Number one, the Muslim says that Jesus is not God. Number two, the Muslim says that Jesus is not the begotten Son of God, because God does not beget. The Muslim says that God is not a triune God, because there is no such thing as three in one and one in three. The Muslim says that Jesus Christ was not killed nor crucified, and hence he was not resurrected. There is no such thing as a resurrection. These are points of real differences between the Muslim and the Christian. But believe me, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, that this wide gulf between the Muslim and the Christian, between Islam and Christianity, is being rapidly bridged. The Christians are coming towards Islam. I'm not talking about the cultists. I'm talking about the learned men of Christianity, who are described in the Holy Quran in these beautiful words. I'm quoting from Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse 85. It says, وَلَتَجِدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. And nearest to them, among them in faith, in love, and nearest among them in love to the believers, to the Muslims, will thou find those who say, we are Christians. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ مِنْهُمْ كِسِّيسِينَ. Because amongst them are men devoted to learning. Among the Christians, says the Holy Quran, are men devoted to learning. وَرُهْبَانًا. And men who have renounced the world. وَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. And people who are not arrogant. Abdullah Yusuf Ali, the commentator of this translation which I was showing it to you, in his note number 789, on this verse comments. He says, the meaning is not that they call themselves Christians, but they are such sincere Christians that they appreciate Muslim virtues, as did the Abyssinians to whom Muslim refugees went during the persecution in Mecca. They would say, it is true we are Christians, but we understand your point of view, and we know you are good men. Abdullah Yusuf Ali concludes that these Christians, they are Muslims at heart. That these Christians, they are Muslims at heart, never mind whatever label they apply for themselves. And I can give you many examples from history of this type of good learned men among the Christians. But time is short, so let me give you some brief references from recent times. Number one, in the Time magazine, July 15, 1974, there were a series of essays under the heading, Who Are History's Great Leaders? And among the contributors, there is one, James Gavin, described as a retired commander-in-chief of the American Army. This James Gavin, in his list of the greatest leaders, he says, number one, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And number two, he puts his own Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, number two. Then, in America again, an American by the name of Michael H. Hart, of the Hart Publishing Company, described as an astronomer and a mathematician, this man, he writes a book of 572 pages, giving the most influential men in history from the time of Adam up to current times. And in his list of 100 most influential men, he puts the Holy Prophet of Islam, Muhammad, number one. And surprisingly, he puts his own Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, number three. Then that is going a bit far. Coming back to our own country, the charming Bill Chalmers, he will be on TV tonight, on what is called Cross Questions, he will be on TV tonight. This Bill Chalmers, at the end of a lively debate on the subject of Islam and Christianity, the very subject of this afternoon's discussion, it was on SABC TV, Islam and Christianity. He commented at the end of the talk in these charming words.
Well, I think it can be said from this discussion that there is, at present, somewhat more accommodation on the Islamic side for the founder of Christianity than there is on the Christian side for the founder of Islam. What the significance of that is, we leave it to you, the viewer, to determine. But I do hope you will agree with us that it's a good thing that we are talking together. Good.
He said, I think it can be said from this discussion, referring to the discussion on TV, that there is at present somewhat more accommodation on the Islamic side for the founder of Christianity than there is on the Christian side for the founder of Islam. That there is more tolerance, there is more compassion on the Islamic side for Jesus Christ than there is on the Christian side for the founder of Islam. He said, what the significance of that is, we leave it to you, the viewer, to determine. But I do think you will agree with me that it is a good thing that we are talking together. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, you are all privileged to see that videotape of that meeting, Islam and Christianity, that great debate that took place on TV. You are privileged to see that tape absolutely free of charge. On VHS or Betamax, whatever you choose, whatever format, absolutely free of charge. If you want to see it, you can see it. You can get it from the propagation center. But you will have to put with us 25 rand security deposit. Because after giving this tape to you, we haven't got the manpower to start running behind you to find out where you are with this tape. So you leave with us 25 rand security. After a week, you return it and take your money back in full. We don't hire it, we will lend it to you. And on that, on this program, you will see something more than what Bill Chalmers tells you. You see, you will find on this tape the reason why Bill Chalmers says, you know, that there is more sympathy from the Islamic side than there is on the Christian side towards Islam. You will find a classical example of a sickness. You see, there is a current sickness prevailing among the Christians of the world. They call it a born again. It's a cult that has been created recently, where they now say that, look, previously with the disciples of Jesus, they had the Spirit with them, but now they say we have it in us. The Spirit is in them, inside, fills them up. And I had one of these sick person coming to my office, wanting to share this sickness with me. I asked him, now you have the Spirit in you? He said, yes. I said, it permeates every fiber of your being? He said, yes. So I said, you can't be tempted. If the Spirit of God fills you up, is there room for the devil to get in? He says, no. So I said, you can't be tempted. He says, no. So I said, congratulations. Congratulations. I said, you know, you're greater than your own God. You are greater than your own Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ was tempted by the devil and you can't be tempted. Amazing. You can't be tempted, but Jesus was tempted. So he said, no, I can also be tempted. Then I said, in that case, you haven't got the Spirit. He says, either way, if you have the Spirit, then you are greater than Jesus. Because Jesus was tempted, his disciples were tempted. You are greater than them all. And if you can be tempted, then you haven't got the Spirit. Rather, you have something rightly described by the Holy Prophet of Islam, He said that Shaitan, the spirit of evil, courses through the body of man like the blood. This is what Shaitan is coursing through the body of man, like the blood. As the blood is flowing in your veins, this devilishness, this evil inclinations, temptations are also coursing through your body. So somebody asked him, he said, what about you? And he was humble enough to admit, he said, me too, but mine is under control. So, talking about these learned Christians, I said there are these learned Christians, they are coming towards Islam. It's the learned men, not sick people. Our biggest points of differences between the Christian and ourselves, things that grated the Muslim most, was this expression that Jesus is the only begotten Son, begotten, not made. This word begetting was grating the Muslims. And it is grating, according to the recitation read by our Qari. He read those words, very strong words. He says, وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدًا. And they say that Ar-Rahman, the merciful God, he has begotten a son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God Almighty, he says in answer to that, he says, لَقَدْ جِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا عِدَّا. It's one of the most abominable assertions one can make. تَقَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَتَّرْنَا مِنْهُ. At it, the skies are ready to burst. وَتَنْشَقَّ الْأَرْضُ. And the earth to split asunder. وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ حَدَّا. And the mountains to fall down in utter ruin. Such a horrible swearing that you say that God begot a son. Because begetting is an animal act. It belongs to the lower animal functions of sex. How can you attribute such a quality to God? So, the learned men of Christianity, 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations of the Christians, they went and produced the revised standard version of the Bible. And they threw this word begotten out unceremoniously. This word begotten in John 3:16. Every Christian worth the name knows it. The most translated sentence of any sentence in the world, John 3:16. Now, look for it in the revised standard version of the Bible. It's thrown out as a fabrication, as an interpolation. I say, here, it is about time that we shook hands with these Christian scholars. He says, thank you very much. Coming closer to Islam. The word that was grating us, they threw it out. To appease us? No. Because they found that it was not there in the original manuscripts. This was somebody who had pushed it in. It's not supposed to be there. It's thrown out. I have the Bible here after the meeting. If you like to check it up, check it up. The word begotten is not to be found. Another point of real difference between the Muslim and the Christian is this thing called Trinity, the Holy Trinity, where the Christian says that the Father is God, the Son is God, and the Holy Ghost is God, but there are not three gods, but one God. You remember that formula? Every Christian has it on his lips. He says the Father is Almighty, the Son is Almighty, and the Holy Ghost is Almighty, but there are not three Almighties, but one Almighty. He continues, the Father is a person, the Son is a person, and the Holy Ghost is a person, but they are not three persons, but one person. I'm asking the Englishman, what language are you speaking? You say, person, 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 but not three person, but one person. What language is that? Oh, of course, that is the language of religion. Now, the only solid basis on which this dogma could be based is to be found in the King James Version and the Roman Catholic Version of the Bible, in the first epistle of John, chapter 5, verse 7, it reads, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. That is the clearest approximation to the Trinity in the Christian Bible. Now, that also has been unceremoniously thrown out of this book. By who? Not by Muslim scholars, not by Jewish scholars, not by Hindu scholars, but by 32 scholars, Christian scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations. They threw it out as a fabrication. It's not there. So I said, congratulations to you, my Christian learned man. Says, I'd like to kiss your hand. Look, they're coming to Islam. They're coming closer and closer to Islam. With regard to the crucifixion, with regard to the resurrection, we have given you a pamphlet when you came in. Jesus as only a messenger. At the back of that pamphlet, you will find a shock survey of Anglican bishops. A shock survey of Anglican bishops. These are paid servants of the Anglican Church. Men of the highest order of learning. The most respected people in Christendom among the Orthodox. In our daily news of the 25th of June this year, Dateline from London, it said, more than half of England's Anglican bishops say Christians are not obliged to believe that Jesus Christ was God. You are not obliged to believe that Jesus Christ is God. And this was a point of real difference between the Muslim and the Christian. They threw it out. They said, if you don't believe in that, you're still an Anglican. They don't want to lose you to Islam. Because that is what the real point of difference is. We say Jesus is not God. The Christians say Jesus is God. But more than half of the bishops now are telling you that you don't have to believe that Jesus is God. That means he is not God. It is not a foundation of your faith anymore. So I said, I take off my hat to these Anglican bishops, as we all ought to do. We take off our hat. What was the purpose? What was the motive? Which Arab sheikh bribed these bishops? Tell me, who bribed them? To do away with the bedrock of Christendom is the divinity of Christ. He said, look, you don't have to believe in that anymore. And further in that same article, you read it at home, that the poll of 31 of England's 39 bishops show that many of them think that Christ's miracles, the virgin birth and the resurrection, might not have happened exactly as described in the Bible. These are something more like fairy tales. These are like fairy tales. It might not have happened. This resurrection of Jesus might not have happened. And we have given you a book, free. Crucifixion or crucifixion, absolutely free. And you read it, and you can't help agreeing that it's a fiction. F-I-C-T-I-O-N, fiction. Not F-I-X-I-O-N, F-I-C-T-I-O-N, fiction. So these learned men of Christendom, described in the Holy Quran as learned, that they are coming towards Islam. I say, congratulations, we take off our hat to you. And only 11 of the bishops insisted that Christians must regard Christ as both God and man, while 19 out of 31, work out the percentage at home, they said that Jesus Christ is nothing other than God's supreme agent. That's what we are saying. That is what the Quran says. Ya ahl al-kitab, O people of the book, O learned people, La taghlu fi dinikum. He said, do not go to extremes in your religion. Wa la taqulu ala Allah illa al-haq. And don't say anything about God except the truth. Innamal Masih, most certainly the Messiah. Isa ibn Maryama, Jesus the son of Mary, Rasulullah, is the messenger of Allah. Look, this is what the Muslim is saying. He's a messenger of Allah. Now the Anglican bishops, 11 out of 31, they say that he's 19 out of 31, they say he's only a messenger. Now this, in this, there is a message for the Muslim, that it is about time that we shared Islam with our fellow countrymen. Look, the learned man, when he makes a discovery, he makes it known by the masses. They don't know what's going on. They are like sheep. They're still kept there in the stable. We have to free them. Bring them over, says, look, these are your learned men. They are confessing without any coercion. There is no Muslim with a sword over his head. You remember that old saying that Islam was spread at the point of the sword? I say, which sword is forcing these people to tell you that whatever the Muslim says, they are agreeing with us, step by step, but they are dragging their feet. It is about time that we push them, rush them. So look, man, this is, what is the, now the difference between us and you? Whatever you said, the differences that existed, the greater the Muslim, you have taken them out. You say you don't believe in them. So why not shake hands and become Muslims? In the words of the Holy Quran, I ended this brief talk by saying, as we are made to say, Qul, tell them. Ya Ahlal Kitab, O people of the book, O learned people, O people with a scripture, Ta'alaw, come. Ila kalimatin sawa'im bainana wa bainakum, that we come to common terms as between us and you. Let us get onto a common platform. And that common platform, this Almighty God, He gives it to us in this holy book. He says, Allah na'buda illallah, that we worship none but Allah. Wala nushrika bihi shay'an, and that we associate no partners with Him. وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْدُنَا بَعْدًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ, and that we do not take from among ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا, but if they turn back, فَقُلُوا شَهَدُوا بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ, tell them that we at least are Muslims. We have submitted our will to the will of God, and we want you to join us in the fellowship of faith, in the brotherhood of faith. وَآخِرُ الدَّعْوَانَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.
Thank you, Mr. Ahmed Didat. Ladies and gentlemen, you will be availed of the opportunity of putting questions to the speaker later. Ladies and gentlemen, Reverend Cunningham, who is now fondly known as Brother Jalaluddin, will address you, whereafter he will introduce the next speaker.
Assalamu alaikum. Before I start saying what I have to say, if anybody wants refreshments, they're on my right at the back, they are available to you. Alhamdulillah, that means all praise is due to Allah. I am a revert. You may wonder what that is. Every child is born a Muslim. According to our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every child born is born a Muslim. And so I too was born a Muslim. But sadly, my folks, my parents, who didn't know any better, taught me the faith of their fathers. They taught me Christianity. And I came to love the church that I belonged to. I came to respect them. And I was raised up a Christian, and all my life I cherished the thought that one day I would pray and work for the church. I would become a priest. I worked hard, I studied hard, and I eventually did go to Rome. But as a young cleric, as a young seminarian, you question a great deal. You learn a lot of dogmas, you learn a lot of philosophies. And I began to question all the time about the oneness of God, the creator of this universe. But I still did not get enough information. I sometimes was a little bit of a headache to my professors, but alhamdulillah, they put up with me. On my return after my ordination to the diaconate, I came back to South Africa, and one of my dearest friends was not at the airport to meet me. I was a little surprised and naturally disappointed. And when I arrived at the airport, my parents said they hadn't seen this fellow. His name was Carl. He was also going to become a priest in the Catholic Church. So I went around to see him. And he told me that he and I could no longer be friends. So I said, what's preventing you and I becoming friends or remaining friends? He said, well, I'm no longer a Catholic. I said, fine, if you're no longer a Catholic, that shouldn't prevent us from being friends. But if you're no longer a Catholic, what are you? He said, I'm a Muslim. I was stunned. I said, a Muslim? They're heathens. They don't believe in God. They don't believe in Christ. Peace be upon him. He said he wasn't prepared to fight with me. He wasn't prepared to argue with me. He said, go along to the people who have taught me Islam and talk to them. So I said, who's done this to you? He said, Ahmed Didat. I said, that does it. I've had enough of this man, I'm going to see him. Which I did. Mr. Didat and Mr. Vanker and Mr. Khan were in the office in Madras Arcade, and I went along. But it was an encounter of the Didat kind. I hadn't anticipated such a man. And within a short period of time, he proved to me, step by step, that there isn't a Trinity. He revealed to me the simplicity and beauty of Allah's word in the Holy Quran. And eventually one Juma, on Friday, which is our congregational day, I was a reciter of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, which means there's no object worthy of worship except Allah, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. It's very difficult when one becomes a revert, and to get back to the revert, very often we imagine or we think that people are converts. Nobody converts to Islam. I said originally, everyone is born Muslim. We just go off the Sirat al-Mustaqim. We go off the straight path. So I reverted back onto the path of Islam. It was difficult, very, very, very difficult. The community I had left were not too happy with me. My family persecuted me. But it's understood. I think if I had a son or a daughter and they were to revert to another religion or convert other than Islam, I would naturally be upset. But alhamdulillah, I found a new life in Canada. I went to live in Canada for a time and started a new practice. I had new friends. I had this new religion. But I was destined to come back. But in all this time that I was away, I wasn't practicing this new religion, this Islam. I was a Muslim. I'd recited the Kalima, but I wasn't practicing it. But now, alhamdulillah, I'm a 5-time namazi. That means I make my salah 5 times a day. And I'm full-time with the Islamic Propagation Center. I'm a missionary for Islam. Having gone to Canada and seen a very beautiful country draws my attention to our guest speaker today, Gary Miller, who comes from Toronto in Canada. He's a Canadian citizen. He's a husband and father of 2 children. And we're indeed very, very fortunate to have him with us, to spend this short period of time he is in South Africa, because he has a very busy schedule. He travels a great deal throughout the world. In fact, he's on his way to Australia for the 2nd time. And we have much in common. Canadian backgrounds, both Catholics, previous Catholics. He had the desire to become a priest, Catholic education. He had Jesuit education. I was also educated by the Jesuits in Rome. He was an altar boy. I was an altar boy. So he really had a lot to talk about yesterday when I met him. And we found out this common denominator. But I had gone from Catholicism to Islam. But Gary here went from Catholicism to something else. And I'm going to get him to tell you about that shortly. And I would like you to give him a good hearing. His credentials are varied. He's a broadcaster. He appears on TV, appears at public lectures and on radio. He's an author. He's deserving of a good hearing. I'd like you to listen to him. I'd like you to ask him as many questions as you'd like. And now I call upon you, Gary Miller, to meet the people of Durban. Jazakallah.
To my Muslim friends, assalamu alaikum. To Christian friends, peace be with you. They both mean the same thing, as it happens. To everyone in general, welcome. Mr. Didat spoke, and of course he said some things that Christians probably don't like to hear. Not necessarily because they're not true things. I mean, it is true that many of the bishops of the Church of England have said Jesus is not divine. That's a fact, they have said that. What is annoying to many Christians is to say, how could a man who calls himself a Christian say that? In any case, I too will say some things that will annoy people, some things that maybe Muslims don't want to hear, some things that maybe Christians don't want to hear. But ask yourself, is it because it wasn't true, or why does it bother me if you don't like to hear what I've said? As my friend has said, we just got into a discussion. I met him for the first time, I believe it was only yesterday. We found out that we did at one time live within a few hundred miles of each other in Canada for a period of about 6 or 8 years, but unless I bumped into him on the street, I don't remember ever meeting him until yesterday. He said that he went from Catholicism into Islam. I went from Catholicism toward the Protestant churches. Now, I have to clarify, though, first, don't misunderstand where we're going. I didn't come here at the invitation of a church. Mr. Didat asked me to come here, didn't pay me to come here. A couple days after I got here, I asked him, who's paying for this trip? He said, we can't afford it. All right, that's the end of that. So nobody paid me to come here. I am invited from time to time to speak in churches, and sometimes I speak in mosques, and most often I simply speak at universities in open forums. You see, a lot of churches like what I say, and a lot of churches don't like what I say. Recently, I was speaking in Vancouver on the west coast of Canada, and when I finished my speech, somebody came up and told me how horrible it was. He said, as a Christian, he was very offended by what he heard, and he was very upset. And another man right behind him came up, and he was a minister in the United Church of Canada. That's the largest denomination in Canada. He shook my hand. He said, that was beautiful. I want your name and address. I liked what you said. So you see, you can't ever paint all Christians with one brush. They come from one extreme to the other. Any two differences you can think of, there'll be people in between those two extremes. So please understand, some churches appreciate what I say, some do not. To clarify some terminology, I was surprised to find this morning I looked in the newspaper talking about things going on in the city today, and it said Gary Miller is going to be speaking, an evangelist. Well, for years in doing evangelical work with churches, preaching on the street corner or in a church or anywhere that I went, people would tell me, that's evangelism you're doing, you're an evangelist. And I used to tell them, I prefer you wouldn't use that word. Because as carefully as I've ever looked through the Bible, I never found the word evangelist on the lips of Jesus. I'm not saying it's a bad word. You want to call yourself an evangelist? Be my guest. Me, I prefer not to. Always preferred not to, because I didn't see Jesus use that word. That doesn't mean it's wrong. I'm just trying to take only what I ever saw that he said, and he never used that word. I was surprised to hear yesterday that, where did he go? My friend here told me that he got a phone call from somebody who wanted to know my credentials. By what authority and power did I speak about Islam and Christianity? I was kind of surprised to hear that. The caller said he was a Christian. It's a very unchristian thing to do. That's what the Jews and the Romans and so on used to ask about the disciples of Jesus. You find in Acts chapter 4, among other places, when the disciples would try to preach, the Romans or the Jews would say, by what authority do you preach? What school did you go to? You're just a fisherman. How do you dare to speak? So I'd hope that's not typical of most people, that they seem to think a Christian today has to be like a Pharisee. He has to go through the school and get a certificate and he's approved. I can give you credentials like that if you want, but I'd be ashamed to lower myself to that level. Now, please understand, no matter what you think you hear me say, I am trying to help the Christian missionary, all right? Somebody told me a few minutes ago, you can't help the Christian missionary if you stand on the same platform with Ahmed Didat. I'm trying to help the Christian missionary. Listen carefully. A lot of people don't see it that way, of course. Because a lot of people, Muslims and Christians alike, they want to drink milk all their lives. See, if you give a baby milk and you keep giving him milk, he'll get bigger and bigger, but suppose you never gave him anything else but milk. After some time, he starts to get sick. There comes a time when you need meat and fruit and vegetables. Paul wrote that in one of his letters. It's in the Bible. He said, let's go beyond the milk. He said, we've got to get into the meat. See, most of the Christian community and the Muslim community alike, they want to come and go to their meetings on a weekly basis and hear the same old thing over and over. Don't forget to pray, praise the Lord, hallelujah, and so on. They never want any meat. You see, this is milk. We all know this. We have to go beyond this sometimes. When I say I'm trying to help the missionary, I'm talking about this. I'm saying to the missionary, you want to convert the Muslim to Christianity? But look what you're doing instead. You say you're trying to convert the Muslim. You write books, you have speeches and so on. You want to convert the Muslim. Instead of converting the Muslim, look what you're doing because of what you say. You see, the missionary wants the Muslim to start thinking. So he asks him some questions. He has discussions and so on. He plants little seeds. He wants the Muslim to start thinking. But the missionary does not tell the Muslim what to think. He just wants him to start thinking. He doesn't tell him what to think because the missionary usually hasn't thought about it himself. Now, if that sounds serious, let me illustrate what I'm getting at by a few examples. The missionary says to the Muslim, does the Quran say that Jesus was sinless? The Muslim says, yes, perfect man, never sinned. And the missionary says, does the Quran tell Muhammad to repent? And the Muslim says, yes, he tells him to repent. And that's all. Missionary doesn't say anything else. He hopes now the Muslim is going to start thinking, well, now, wait a minute. Jesus never sinned, but Muhammad was supposed to repent. Maybe Jesus is better. He's hoping, but he doesn't dare say that. Because if he says that, if he says, do you know, a sinless man is better than a repentant sinner. If he dares to say that, he goes exactly against the teachings of Jesus. If he's foolish enough to say that, he goes exactly against the teachings of Jesus. My advice to Muslims, if somebody asks you those questions, you ask him to tell you the story of the prodigal son. Everybody knows the story in the Bible. You say, the story of the prodigal son, the young man who told his father, give me the money that I would get when you die. I want it now. And then he ran away and he spent it on terrible things. Ask him to tell you that story and tell you what is the lesson of that story. Because the lesson of that story involves the complaint of the other brother in the family, the good son. When the evil son came back and repented, the father welcomed him. And the good son complained. He said, I've never done anything wrong. And yet, look how you treat my brother, who was so bad. And his father told him how wrong an attitude that was. He said, your brother was dead, now he's alive. You see, the perfect man does not have any preference over the sinless man or the repentant sinner in Christianity. Make the missionary tell you the story of the lost sheep. Jesus said, Matthew chapter 18, verse 12, it starts. Jesus said, what do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the hills and go in search of the one that went astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 that never went astray. Jesus was trying to hammer that point home to his disciples, saying, don't you dare say because, for example, you've been a faithful follower for many years, that you're better than this one who just became a believer yesterday. The perfect man has no precedence over the repentant sinner. In fact, this whole argument would not exist if both Muslims and Christians were better aware of the meaning of the word sin, but that's another story and we don't have time for. To illustrate again, the missionary says to the Muslim, was Jesus the Messiah? And the Muslim says, yes. And the missionary says, was Muhammad the Messiah? And the Muslim says, no. There he stops again, hoping the Muslim will go away and think, now, wait a minute. Jesus is Messiah, but Muhammad isn't. Maybe Jesus is better. Well, what you want to ask the missionary is about this word Messiah. Ask him. Jesus was the Messiah, but were there any other messiahs besides Jesus? Now you find out how well he knows his Bible, because there were many. David, Solomon, even Cyrus the Persian were called Messiah. It's hard to find that in the Bible because the translators cover it over. They translate the word. Messiah means anointed, somebody picked to do a job. Somebody single out said, you are the one. Every king of ancient Israel was called Messiah. Now the name doesn't look quite so special anymore. It is a title, but it does not particularly elevate to some divine status. I'm trying to show you that the arguments are not good enough that are being used and I see in print all the time. The missionary asks the Muslim, where's the body of Jesus? And the Muslim says, God took it. And the missionary says, where's the body of Muhammad? And the Muslim says, it's in Medina, in the ground. The missionary stops, hoping the Muslim will go away and think, now that's interesting. The body of Jesus is gone. Muhammad is in the grave. Maybe Jesus is the true messenger. Muhammad is false. He's hoping you'll think that, but he dare not say it. Because what you want to ask the missionary, is that what you mean to say? Do you mean that a dead and buried prophet is a false prophet? Is that what you mean? Make him finish it. Because if that's what he means, what does he say about Abraham, for example? Or in Arabic, they say Ibrahim. Jews and Muslims till now still go to the place where he's buried, to visit his grave. Is he a false prophet because he's dead and in the ground? For that matter, where is the body of Moses? The Bible says God took it. He sent an angel to take the body away. What does it prove? What disturbs me most, I guess, because even now we're seeing finally a turnaround in the Pentecostal churches where for years the Pentecostal insisted you're saved not by works but by your faith. Pentecostal church is starting to finally put the two together. No, it's faith and works side by side. What the missionary has always accused the Muslim of is to say, you people believed you're saved by works alone. And they quote the Quran. In the 32nd chapter of the Quran, the 19th verse, or ayah, it says, if you'll excuse my terrible Arabic, Amaladina amanu wa amalu salihat falahum janatul mawa nuzalan bima kanu ya'malun, which means, and for those who believe and do good works, for them, gardens, a refuge, and entertainment for what they used to do. They quote this verse saying, you see, Muslims believe they're saved by works alone. Somehow, the word is there in print, they don't see it. It says, amanu wa amalu salihat. Amanu, they believe, wa amalu salihat, and they do good works. They believe and they do good works. The two are together. You see, in the Arabic language, the word only has to change a little bit, and it becomes a different part of speech. Amanu means they believe. Iman, made from the same letters, means what you believe, your belief, your faith. What this verse is saying is you've got to have faith and works side by side. Not one, not the other, but both. Which is exactly what is found in the Bible, in the little book of James, especially the second chapter of the little book of James. Now, the Protestant reformers at first didn't like James very much. Martin Luther said it was an epistle of straw. Blow it away. Didn't like it. In the second chapter of James, he makes the point several times, particularly in the 26th verse, he says to the Christian community, for as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so faith apart from works is dead. It's not faith or works, it's faith and works together. That's what the Muslim believes. That's what the book of James says. Don't tell the Muslim he believes he's saved by works alone. He doesn't believe it. And he only thinks you're foolish because you think that's what it says in the Quran when you quote it to him. So far, my points are simply these, that discussions about the sinless Jesus or Jesus the Messiah or Jesus taken into heaven or faith in works don't prove anything. They're not arguments that are going to lead somewhere. The complaint I have against Muslims is sometimes you let yourself be led around by the nose. Think! I'll just say, well, the man's an expert. I don't know. Think. It's not how much you know, it's what do you do with what you know, how much do you use your head. Even the Bible tells people, let's reason together. God says, come, let us reason together in the first chapter of Isaiah. Now, it is true that the Quran is very critical of some Jews and Christians, not all, some Jews and Christians. The Quran is critical of them. In the third chapter of the Quran, the third surah, beginning about the 77th verse or ayah, it speaks of some among the Jews and Christians. It says, there is among them a group who distort the book with their tongues. You would think that it is part of the book, but it is no part of the book. And they say, that is from God, but it is not from God. It is they who tell a lie against God, and well they know it. Now the Muslim is familiar with this scripture. From his book, it says, look, some of the Jews and Christians lie about the contents of their book. They distort it. The Muslim has every reason to believe this is true when he just looks at what is offered in literature. He goes into a bookstore that sells Bibles and he finds that there's so many different versions. And if he looks carefully, he sees that the newer Bibles leave out some of the words that are in the older Bibles. And the newer Bibles have some words that aren't in the older Bibles. Something's going on that looks funny to him, and he thinks of this verse. Now, of course, someone is going to go away, many are probably going to go away, and say that I stood here and I insulted Bible translators because it's the translators of the Bible that do that. I'm not. I'll be happy to insult a few because they do this kind of thing. They're guilty of manipulation. But just as Jesus used to talk to a crowd of people, he told them what he wanted to tell them, and every so often he'd see someone in the audience, a Pharisee or somebody that was misleading the people, and he'd point him out and say, that one is a liar. He was not diplomatic. That's why he got into so much trouble from place to place. Because when he saw a liar, he pointed him out as such. I'm not going to do that, but I'm just showing you. If you speak harshly of someone, you're only following the example of Christ. He found that there was a time and a place to single out the people who led others into unbelief. You see, some translators of the Bible are honest, and they fight with their contemporaries over the proper translations to say, you've changed that, it should be this. They fight about it. Two of them, for example, are Goodspeed and Moffat, whose Bibles are printed under their own names because no church would back them up. They were too honest. As I said, the Quran is critical of some Jews and Christians. It says in the third surah that the Quran is furqan. In Arabic, it means criterion. It explains in the third verse that the Quran is supposed to be used as the basis of judging which is true and which is false in their scriptures. It says in the fifth surah that the Quran reveals much of what the Jews and the Christians used to hide. Now, of course, the Jew and the Christian doesn't like to hear that. But they do quote some of the Quran back to the Muslim. But they do it badly, is what I'm trying to tell you. They quote it back badly in this way. They try to make it serve their purpose. There's no escaping it. The Quran says the Jews and the Christians hide things, they change things, and so on. So there's no sense in trying to find a verse somewhere that to prove that, no, the Quran says that everything in the Bible is true. But that's what people do. In the fifth chapter of the Quran, they quote a verse, again, if you excuse my Arabic, which says, وَأَنزَلْنَا لَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ بِالْحَقِّ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. They quote this and it says, the translation is, speaking of the Quran, that it is sent down to the Prophet, it says, and we sent down to you the book in truth, confirming that which they possessed of the book before. And you see, the Christian says, you see there, the Quran says the Bible is true. It says the Quran was sent down to confirm, to say it's truthful what they have in their book. That's what that sentence says, if you stop there, but that's the middle of the sentence. There's two more words in the sentence. They are wa muhaiminan alaihi. You see, the whole text says, we have sent down the book in truth, confirming that which they had of the book before this, and as a watcher over it, their book. Muhaiminan is the Arabic word. Muhaiminan is an interesting word. It means quality control. You'd use a form of that word to designate the man in a factory who stands at the end of the assembly line and finds the rejects and throws them out. The whole text, that whole verse from the Quran says, the Quran confirms that which is truthful in their book, and it's the quality control agent. It's the thing that shows you which parts are not true. You don't fool a Muslim by quoting that if he goes and looks it up himself and realizes you only read half the sentence. It's a dishonest quote. Now, of course, some missionaries respond with great pain on their faces. They say to the Muslim, when the Muslim says, you have changed your scriptures, he says, oh, how can you say that? How could you as a Muslim change the Quran? You couldn't do that. How could I change the Bible? Well, the answer is very easy, very easy. The Bible's not the same thing as the Quran, for at least three reasons. The Quran has always been in the hands of the people, always. From the time of the Prophet, people wrote it down if they could write, and they memorized it and so on. It's always been in the hands of the people. Nobody ever disagreed on what were the contents. The Prophet died, his friends met, and they agreed by gathering all the writings they had, said, this is the Quran, and nobody disputed it. Nobody said, no, you left something out. No, this doesn't belong. Nobody argued from the beginning. The Bible doesn't have that history. The Bible has been the property of the church, not the people. The first table of contents to the Bible that reads the same as the contents of the Bible now dates from the year 367, more than 300 years after Jesus. Finally, they decided which books belong in the Bible. It's point one. Point two, the Bible is in dead languages. The Quran is in a living language. 120 million people speak Arabic, the language of the Quran. The Bible is written in ancient Hebrew, ancient Aramaic, and ancient Greek, which nobody speaks. A handful of scholars know it. So that to change it is an easy thing if you're a translator, to read one thing and tell somebody something else. That's easy. Third point, there has never been so much as a letter in dispute about the Quran. No one has even so much as said, this letter is wrong in your copy of the Quran, unless it's a misprint. But nobody ever disputes, no, it should be this, it should be that, and we have a battle over it. Whereas the Bible has come down from many, many manuscripts. Any Bible that's worth buying is filled with footnotes. Almost every page will have a footnote. So you read the verse, footnote, read down here, it says, or this verse might be, and it gives you an alternate translation or what some other manuscript says. So when somebody says, I mean, it's a shallow argument if somebody says, look, Muslims can't change the Quran, how could Christians change the Bible? It's because they're two different kinds of thing. Now, to doubt the authenticity of the Bible is not a Muslim idea. It's not Muslims who became the enemies of the Bible somehow. They're not enemies of the Bible. The doubtful authenticity of the Bible is an old idea found within the Bible. It's a biblical idea. See, if you ask the question, who wrote the Bible? I mean, who took the ink and the pen and put the words on the page? Who did that? The answer, the scribes. That was their job in ancient time. The scribes meant they wrote the scriptures. Well, in Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 8, it talks about the scribes. Now, some Jews will tell you that Jeremiah is the only authentic book left in the whole Bible. I don't believe that myself, but that's how sure they are about Jeremiah. The most authentic book in the Bible, they say. Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 8, it says, how can you say we are wise and the law of the Lord is with us? But behold, the false pen of the scribe has made it into a lie. See, in this place, God is telling you, don't be so sure that everything you have in your hands is scripture. The scribes write lies with their pens. Watch out. Where are these lies if everything in the Bible is legitimate? So what I'm trying to get at is that the Muslim agrees with most churches. Most churches say, yes, the Bible contains the words of God and some other words besides that. The Muslim agrees. The Bible contains the words of God and some other words. It's only a minority Christian position who will say every word in the Bible came from God. None of it came from man. That's a minority view, but it seems to be the view that the missionary feels he has to sell, even if he doesn't believe it himself. There's many ways of establishing that fact, but a basic point is made in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8. This is a verse that some people like so much. The Bible I have there is a New American Standard. They put it on the inside front cover. They like this verse so much. Isaiah 40 and 8. It says, "The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever." It's saying if it's the word of God, it doesn't get lost. It stands forever. God says it, it will always be there, according to this verse. But the churches which say the Bible is totally without error will always modify that by saying they believe the Bible to be inerrant, that is, without error, inerrant in the original manuscript, not the manuscripts we have today, in the original. So that if you show someone, look, this disagrees with that, or this is incorrect, and so on, he can tell you, that's true, that's a mistake. But that mistake was not in the original. Ask him, how did the mistake get here? He'll tell you, the original got lost. Well, then the original was not the word of God if it got lost, was it? Isaiah 40 and 8 says, if God says it, it doesn't get lost. The verse doesn't say, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever, except for a few little details. There's no qualification. And books have been written documenting the errors, and yet this excuse is still offered. You see, if the missionary would only make this concession, if he would only say, all right, not all of the Bible came from God, he'd be more believable. I have a Muslim friend of mine in Toronto who was besieged by a missionary group there, the Fellowship of Faith, whose whole goal in life is to convert Muslims, surrounded by them constantly. Gave him all kinds of literature in that. And finally he told me, he said, you know, the miracle of this book, he meant the Bible, he says, is that people believe it came from God. He said, that's the miracle. Because on the one hand, people are trying to tell him it's perfect, and on the other hand, they'll tell you, well, except here it's not perfect, and so on, but that's because it got lost, and so on. It's an excuse that's inconsistent with the claim. If the missionary would say, not everything that we call Scripture should be called Scripture, if he would only say that, he'd be more believable. Now, as I said, I know some of that probably is upsetting to some people. If it's upsetting, ask yourself why. Did I make a mistake? Did I say something is not true? If so, what is it? My own personal experiences are not particularly exciting or anything, but maybe they illustrate a course of events that you might find interesting. You see, when I was in high school, taught in high school by Franciscans, later in university by Jesuits, I get the highest grades they ever had in religion. I used to write A++++ across the front of the page. Great praise, the teacher said, never had a student like this. These terrific grades in religion. But it occurred to me one day after two or three years of this, it somehow registered on my mind, the reason the grades are high is because I remember everything the man said. When it comes time for an exam, I can write down everything I heard him say and give it back. So I get a perfect mark. That doesn't mean it's true. That was my frustration. But I took it with my teacher saying, I can tell you all of this. I know the whole explanation. What is the proof? You see, we have to always decide when somebody's having a conversation with us, are they explaining it or are they proving it? People usually fool themselves. They explain it and they think they're proving it. If you ask somebody, how do you know Jesus died for your sins? What's the proof? He starts to tell you about, well, you see, God is holy, man's a sinner, Jesus has to die, and so on. That's not the proof, that's an explanation. That's how it's supposed to work. I know that. How do you know it happened, you see? It's the proof you want. In the Catholic Church, I couldn't find that proof, because they tend to look to authorities other than the Scripture, the Bible. Don't be confused. If there's one thing I wish I could hammer into everybody's head, it's this idea. Explanation is not the same as proof. I asked a man the last time I was in Australia. Same thing. I said, how do you know man has to have his sins redeemed? And he said, well, God is 100% holy. 100% holy. You are a sinner. God cannot deal with you directly because he is 100% holy. You are a certain percentage sinner. It's an explanation. It's an explanation, but is it true? See, think about it. If I told you that in New York City is the holiest man that ever lived, I could talk about him for an hour maybe, and I build up a great reputation. I say, he's the holiest human being that ever lived. Finally, maybe you'd say, well, I'm going to save my money. I want to go to New York City and meet him. I want to shake his hand. And I'll tell you, no, no, no. He won't even let you come in the same room with him. He's too holy. You can talk to his secretary, but he couldn't stand to look at you. He's too holy. Now what do you think of this man? Is he holy or is he crazy? See, an explanation is an explanation. It may or may not be true. It's proof of something else. What I wanted was proof. Did Jesus say so? I got into a discussion with a man who used to have a radio program on the Bible. And so I asked him if he could prove to me some of the things he believed. He said, I don't have a Bible. I said, I have one here. I put a Bible, which is called a red letter edition. They put all of the words of Jesus in red ink. And I'd ask him, do you believe such and such? And he'd say, certainly, here's the proof. And he'd open up the Bible and he'd read me something from the black ink. And I kept saying, no, show me in the red ink. Did Jesus say that thing? I said, I know Paul said it. I know this and that and the other thing. Did Jesus say that thing you tell me you believe? Well, he kept stroking my Bible like it was a pet cat. He was very fond of it. But I kept pushing that way and pushing. I kept saying, did Jesus say it? Suddenly, he didn't like the Bible anymore and he threw it back in my face. He said, you know what your problem is? You won't believe it unless Jesus said it. Yes, that's my problem. It should be his problem. How does he dare to teach something if he can't and call himself a Christian if he can't show you that Jesus said this thing he's talking about? It should be easy to find if Jesus said some of the things people say he said. Should be easy to find. Do you know if you took all the words of Jesus reported in the Bible and eliminate the duplications, because you have the same story basically told four times, if you eliminate the duplications, the total of all the words of Jesus do not even fill two columns of a newspaper. There's not very many words. So if he said these different things, you don't really have a lot of work to look down and find them. So as I say, among Protestant churches, I have been involved with the Church of England, the Presbyterians, Pentecostals, Baptists, Jehovah's Witnesses, Christadelphians, you name them. You probably can't name one I haven't heard of unless it's something local here. To be involved with them for 9 years. I read their books and visited, took part in their meeting, used to teach some of their Bible classes. I kept coming back to this, what proof do you offer? What proof? So they bring out a handful of their favorite verses. John 3:16, 8:58, 10:30, 14 and 9, 20 and 28, and so on. But for every one of those verses, there's another verse, which if you put it right beside that verse, you find out what they were trying to say won't work. Hebrews 11:17, Exodus chapter 3, John chapter 17, John chapter 5, and Exodus chapter 6, to go in the order of the verses I named you there. You put those beside those verses, and the argument dissolves, among others. They don't prove the divinity of Jesus. Doesn't mean he's not divine, but these things don't do the job. That's the problem. I'm not saying he's not divine. I'm saying I still want to see the proof. Did he say so? Then the real test of sincerity was what disappointed me. You see, you can take one of these verses, somebody shows you John 14 and 9, for example. Jesus said to Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So I asked them, how is it he said in this other place to a group of people, you people have never seen the Father? Don't tell me in this place he means he's God, when in this place he told some people who were looking at him, you've never seen God. He must have meant something else. You tell somebody that and they'll say, okay, you have a point. What about this verse? And they go to another verse. It's fine. But next week, somebody will come to that same man and say, where's the proof that Jesus said he was God? He will read John 14 and 9, right back where he started from. A verse which a week ago he told me wasn't good enough. It'll be good enough for somebody else because he hopes he doesn't know the response I had. Beginning about 1969, The same story I seem to get when I go from church to church. I'd ask them, you know, if you took all the words of Jesus and you cut them out of the Bible with a scissors, and then I gave you some paste and told you put them back together any way you like, take all these words, put them back together, paste them together how you like, you still can't make him spell out the Trinity. He still doesn't say anything about it, no matter how you change these words. And so they'd tell me, it doesn't mean it isn't true. The Trinity is an evolved understanding. The church didn't understand this deep thought at first. The understanding evolved over the centuries. It was discussed. People came to understand it and believe it. Fine. But if that's what you say, you shouldn't say, on the other hand, Jesus used to preach it. If you tell me people didn't figure it out for 200 years, don't tell me Jesus preached it. And so they would say, No, he preached it, but it's not in the Bible. He used to preach it to his disciples. He told them about it. Well, in the 18th chapter of John, Jesus says very clearly, I taught nothing in secret. He said, everything I had to say, I said in the marketplace. He didn't tell his disciples any secrets. More solutions are offered to me. People told me, your problem is you're not spiritual enough. Believe, then it's easy. Believe. But you see, a person can't make themselves believe if they know better. What sometimes happens to human beings, they get a pain, so their head is hurting. They go to a doctor, they tell him, I've got this pain, it won't go away. The doctor makes some tests, a full examination, maybe some x-rays, and he finds there's nothing wrong. So he realizes the man's problem is mental. It's an imaginary pain. He doesn't tell the man that. He gives him a placebo. They are things that look like pills, but they're only milk sugar. Just sugar. He goes to his patient and he says, we've made some tests. This is the medicine you need. Take these pills, and in one day, your pain should stop. It almost always does, because the man thinks he's getting some medicine. And so his mental abilities get rid of the pain. That's a placebo. It works that way. I can't do the same thing with belief, though. I can't manufacture it. You see, if the doctor came to me and he said, you know, your problem is mental. I have some sugar pills here. Believe that these are medicine with all your heart. Believe they are medicine. Try very hard. And when you believe that they are medicine, the pain will go away. I can't do it. He told me they're sugar. I know better. So in the same way, it's not satisfactory that somebody comes and he says, believe, believe, believe. How can you believe if you know better? Faith overcomes, people told me. Faith overcomes. You must be born again. And that I took a real interest in. You must be born again. I want to know, how does this work? Where's the proof in the scripture? They brought me Romans chapter 8. It's very interesting. Romans chapter 8, Paul says, if you are born again, what happens is the Spirit of God comes into you and it tells you that God is now your Father, and so you cry out, Abba, Father. So this is how it's supposed to work. It's fascinating. I gave that a lot of thought. But I got to thinking about this word Abba. It's unusual. It means Father in Aramaic. So I looked up the word Abba. Where else is it in the Bible? Well, there's only one other place that Paul talks about Abba. I'll let you find it for yourself. One other place he talks about Abba. And in this place, he also talks about how it is that this thing works. He says, the Spirit of God comes within you. You become a child of God. You call out to God, Abba, Father. Now God is your Father. And he goes on to say, now you have a new mother also. A new mother. God is your Father and you have a mother. Since 1969 till now, 15 years, I have yet to meet someone who's born again and ask them, who's your father? They say, God. I say, who's your mother? They don't know. Why not? It's in the Bible. It says you have a new mother if you're born again. Why did the Spirit of God, when it came within you, forget to tell you who was your mother? It's there. Let you find it. It's there. It's important. You see, in Islam, if you call a man a liar, you better have proof, or you're the one that's in trouble. If somebody over there calls me a liar, he better have proof, you see, unless he's not a Muslim. If other religions permit you to call that name without proof, that's their business. Now, as I say, for many years I went directly to priests and ministers. from about 1969 till 77, thereabouts. And round we go. I don't want to bore you with a lot of the conversations, but they go around in tiny little circles, and it's disappointing. People ask me, they say, who was the father of Jesus? I say, he didn't have a father. And they say, well, then, you see, Mary is the mother, God is the father. So I would ask, do you mean Mary is the wife of God? No, they're horrified. No. God is the father, Mary is the mother. And I'd ask, you mean his parents weren't married, though? No, God doesn't take a wife. So we go on to something else. And they say, but Jesus called God Father. And I always ask people who tell me that, I say, what do you call God? Probably it's Father. People who say that, they pray, our Father. But he called himself Son of God, they say. And I tell them, yes, and he called lots of other people Son of God. He said, blessed are the peacemakers, they shall be called sons of God. I became very frustrated on the crucifixion. I believed that the crucifixion happened, but I want to know why. I asked so many people, I said, why did God have to become a man and die? If a price has to be paid for our sins, why can't we just go find a sinless man and execute him and say, there, the price is paid? To which people always said, no, if a man dies, it's not enough. It has to be someone who is God and man. And so I'd always ask them, do you mean God died? Say, no, only the man died. We're back where we started from. If the man dies, it isn't good enough. See, that's not a novel idea on my part. The church is still discussing that till this day. They're still not sure who died on the cross. Was it God or was it man or was it the God-man or what was the deal? Because if God doesn't die, because that means changing from one state to another, and God doesn't change from one state to another, he's supposed to be immutable, and so on. They're still discussing that. They say Jesus paid a price for your sins. Paid a price. Could never understand that. In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. He said, pray like this. And one of the lines he told them, he said, pray to God, say, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. More modern translations say, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. How do you forgive someone who owes you a debt? Do you say, you know that money you owe me? Forget it. Now give me the money. If you forgive it, there's no price. Nothing is paid. You say, it's forgiven. So the Lord's Prayer says, forgive us our sins the same way we forgive someone who sinned against us. If someone slaps you, and you forgive him, that's the end of that. But you don't say, I forgive you for slapping me. Now come here, I want to slap you. You see? You don't do that. About, what would it be, 500 years ago, there was a Jew in Europe. Spinoza was his name, Baruch Spinoza. A philosopher, and he wrote a great deal. And he made the same point that people were making 500 years before him. He was frustrated when the Christians would come to him and say, God became man. He would say, what do you mean? God became man. See, I know what is God and I know what is man. And I can imagine that what was God turned into a man. It's not God anymore. He used to be God. Now he's a man. I can understand that. That at least makes some sense. But that's not what the church teaches. They say, God became man, but he was still God. And that causes a problem. You see, if I have a ball of clay and I squeeze it and I put corners on it and I make it into a cube, I can tell you, you see, the ball became a cube, but I can't tell you, don't be fooled, it's still round. See, if it was one thing, it became another thing, it's not that thing anymore. They solve that by putting a label on it. They call it diophysitism. Doesn't prove anything. It means two natures. Diophysitism. That's an old trick. When you don't know the answer, put a label on it. In ancient Greece, the Greeks, 25 centuries ago, came to their scientists with a question. They'd observed that you eat food, it goes through the system, and some of it comes out. They wanted to know which part of what I take in is the part that feeds me, because evidently I don't need all of it, you see. I want to know which is the nutritive faculty of the food. And the scientists didn't know, so they said, the part that feeds you is the nutritive faculty of the food. It's like saying the part that feeds you is the part that feeds you. That's all. It's a label. It doesn't answer anything. As I say, I could talk to you for hours about experiences. About 1977, I decided to have a look at the Quran. I never met a Muslim. I lived 100 kilometers from the nearest Muslim. See, what interested me was what non-Muslims said about Muhammad. There are books and books written about Muhammad that tell you, one thing we know for sure about this man, he had an outside source of information. One book I've got says the Quran was written by a committee. Because they've established so well that there's information in there that an Arabian shouldn't have known. He must have had someone from the outside bringing him this information. So they say, one thing we know for sure, he had an outside source of information. Now, he said this book was a revelation. So they say, you see, he was a liar. He got it from somewhere, he put it in a book, and he gave it to someone, telling him it was from God. He was a liar. Other people write books and books on the subject of Muhammad, and they say, one thing we know for sure, he thought he was a prophet. He was crazy. Because they look at his life very carefully, and they see episodes like, for example, when he hid in the cave with Abu Bakr. He was running from the whole city who wanted to kill him, and he hid in the cave, and when the Meccans came running up to the cave to kill them, what did he say to his friend? Did he tell him, see if you can find a back way out of the cave? What he told his friend was, relax. He was telling him, you know, I see what you see, but he said, God is with us. God will save us. So people on that basis, they say, you see, he thought he was a prophet. He thought God was with him because he said things like that. He wasn't a liar. They never seem to realize that one man can't be both. So you can't be a liar and a crazy man at the same time. If you think that an angel gives the words of God in your ear, and somebody says, I have a question for you, what does God tell you about this thing? I'll want to hear an answer tomorrow. If you're a crazy man, if you think an angel whispers in your ear, then you don't sit up that night thinking, what will I tell him tomorrow? What can I find? Who knows the answer? You're crazy. You think the angel will tell you the answer. You don't go and look it up somewhere. So you can't be a liar and a crazy man at the same time. You can be one or the other or neither, but you can't be both. You see, I read two non-Muslim biographies of Muhammad. One was by Rodinson, who's an atheist, who hated the man. But many interesting things come up about his life that I had to wonder about. One story that's told is that when he was an older man, he had a son named Abraham. The son died when the child was 2 years old. The same day the boy died, there was an eclipse of the sun. The sky went dark. And the Muslims came running to their prophet and said, look, it's a miracle. Your child died and the sky went dark in sadness. It occurred to me, see, if he was a crazy man, he'd probably believe what they said. He'd probably think, yes, it's a miracle. My child died, the sky is dark. Yes, it's a miracle. If he was a crazy man. If he was a liar, he would have taken advantage of it. He would have said, yes, right, my child died, the sky is dark, you tell everyone, it proves I'm a prophet. It's a miracle. But what did he do? He became angry with the Muslims. He told them that was nonsense. He was angry with them. How dare you say that? He said, the sun and the moon are signs of God, and they don't worry themselves about the birth of a man or the death of a son of Muhammad. Doesn't look very crazy, doesn't look much like a liar. Now, you have a third alternative, of course, which people tell you all the time. You say, no, he was not a liar. He was not a crazy man. He was deceived by the devil. Deceived by the devil. It's an interesting idea. But whatever you say, you better be ready to back it up. There's a lot of difficulties with that idea. For example, there is a verse in the Quran which tells the reader about a good habit to develop. It tells him, before you read this book, always say, A'udhu billahi minashaitani rajim, which means, I take refuge in God from Satan, the rejected. Is this Satan who wrote this? who said, before you read my book, ask God to save you from me? Is that Satan who wrote that? As Jesus said, if Satan is divided against himself, then his kingdom will fall. He's fighting against his own interests. So let me finish with a story that illustrates a point. As I said, there's many theories and many explanations around. Many explanations. But an explanation, something somebody tells you, is just so much air coming out of his mouth unless he has proof, and unless he offers you something that you can use to falsify it. You see, there's many theories of how do the planets go around the sun and how do the stars burn and all the rest of it. Many theories. Most of them are just so much wind. Scientists pay no attention to them because they don't contain something that could be checked to prove it false. You see, Einstein was considered an intelligent man because when he offered his theory in 1905 and again in 1915, he didn't just offer a theory, he said, here's three ways to prove I'm wrong. Now it's worth listening to. He's told me, here's three different things you can do. If you can do this, I'm wrong. Here you are. Is there anything like that in Christianity? Has the Christian ever said, you want to prove I'm wrong? All you have to do is this. Has he ever done that? The Quran is filled with that kind of thing, filled with it. Saying, you want to prove this book is wrong? Do this. Prove it. Go ahead. Do it. Filled with that kind of thing. There's an example of it that made a big impression in its day, during the lifetime, 14 centuries ago, of the Prophet of Islam. You see, he had an uncle named Abu Lahab. That was his nickname, Abu Lahab. This man hated Muhammad. He hated anything the man said. He used to watch him going through the city, and if he saw him talking to someone, he waited till they split up. He'd go after the man he spoke to and take him and say, what did Muhammad tell you? Whatever it is, it's a lie. Did he tell you day? It's night. Did he say black? It's white. Exact opposite. Whatever he heard the Muslims say, he said the opposite. That was the way his mind worked. There's a little chapter of the Quran called Lahab, and it says about this man that he'll never change. It condemns him to hell, Jahannam. You see, if the man had ever become a Muslim, the Muslims would believe, well, now he's not condemned anymore. You see, for 10 years before Abu Lahab died, that was a part of the Quran. And the Muslims could come to Abu Lahab and say, do you know, it's been revealed to us in our book that you will never be a Muslim. God says you will never be a Muslim. For 10 years, they told him that. All he had to do was say, well, your book is wrong. I want to be a Muslim. What do you think of your book now? That's all he had to do. He had 10 years to think about it. And that's the way he was. See, if somebody is your enemy, you don't come to him and say, you want to prove I'm wrong? Here, say this. Come on, say it. If all you have to do is say the words and I'm wrong, you finish me. He never did it. See, this is one of many cases of something that was offered that could have been falsifiable. So it was. As I say, in 1978, after, along with it be, 15 years of arguing with the church authorities, one place or another, I got the idea, I'm going to argue with some other people, I'm going to read the Quran, see how much of it is any good, pick out the true, pick out the false. Thought it'll take a few years, it'll take some serious study and so on. I read through it, about 3 days later I finished it. I said, this is what I've been saying for 15 years. So I went to find some Muslims. I don't want somebody to feel you've been tricked into something. I haven't said anything about Christianity that isn't true. I haven't said anything about Islam that isn't true, unless it was a slip of the tongue or something. I'm simply trying to remind an individual, don't close your mind before it's too late. Don't make up your mind before you have all the facts. Most people who used to be Christians and become Muslims will tell you, I am a better Christian than I used to be. Now I follow Christ. I didn't before. That's what I would tell you. The Bible says Jesus told his disciples, when you greet one another, let your greeting be, peace be with you. He set the example, peace be with you. Who says that today? Christians? Once in a great while, maybe. Muslims, whether they speak Arabic or not, they say, Salaam alaikum, peace be with you. Jesus, when he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, put his forehead on the ground. Who prays like that, Christians or Muslims? Jesus used to fast for more than a month at a time. Who fasts today, Christians or Muslims? Who really is trying to imitate Jesus? Somebody said to me before coming in here, they said, the Muslims make Jesus out, they insult him and so on and so on. How possibly do they insult him? They lift him up, up. They can't tolerate anything bad said about him. They would just as quickly tell you that, you know, they say Muhammad Rasulullah means Muhammad is the messenger of God. They will just as quickly say Isa, Jesus, Isa, Rasulullah, no problem. Just as quickly tell you that, because it's true. They occupy the same place. If God himself wants to make distinctions among his prophets, that's his business, not ours. Treat them all with the same amount of respect. May God guide us always closer to the truth.
Mr. Gary Raymond Miller, thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now discussion time, or question time. However, there are a few rules which you must follow. Firstly, it is our desire to canvass as broad a spectrum of questions from as large a number of the members of the audience as possible. Each person is therefore restricted to one question. I know sometimes it is unavoidable preceding a question with an explanatory discussion. Where this is absolutely necessary, I request you to be extremely cursory or succinct. However, if at all possible, try and avoid preceding a question with a discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, you're now invited to walk up to the mic, which is a few meters away from ourselves. If at all possible, to name yourselves and to state your designation, as for example, Mr. John Doe, teacher. If you'd prefer to remain anonymous, that suits us. And from there, to put your questions. Ladies and gentlemen, you may now walk up to the mic and ask questions through myself. To the mic near the pole, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have gathered you today in the name of God and this gathering. It will make us understand what God is. Foremost of all, what I'd like to ask these people here, who are teaching us, a very simple question that we may understand what God wants us to do. Okay? Can I speak to you?
You're asking me, how do we know what God wants us to do? Is that what the question was?
That's it. By theology. The word theology means God's relation with man and the universe. Why did God create man and the universe? Where is the answer to this question?
That's okay, you're finished then.
That's
okay.
It.
Theology is an invented word which just means the study of God, and it's not a science like biology is, so that you want to know something about biology, you go and get a book about biology and you read and you grant that what you read is true. Theology, anybody who wants to write about God can write about God, so you can't go and pick up a book about theology and say everything in it must be true. It's like biology. It's not a science like that. It's filled with everybody's opinion. So people's opinions have to be sorted out according to how much they're worth. Now the human mind will reach to a certain point, get some points correct and some points false, but a careful man is supposed to be able to choose, this is the true, this is the false. This makes sense, this is nonsense. Okay, so for a start, you've got your own mind, what you can figure out for yourself and what you can judge from what other people have told you. You take input and so on. To come down to the final detail of it, you need a revelation from God, because The human mind is different from anything else you find in creation. You find little insects, they need something to eat. Sure enough, there's something provided for them. Bigger animals, they need food, there's something else they eat. The plants have something they eat. Everything is provided all the way up the scale. You get to the human being, things are provided for him. There's a place to eat, a place to sleep, and so on. But he's got something nothing else has, a mind that asks questions. So it's only reasonable to believe that if something is provided for all of his other needs, he has a need to know something must be provided. He should look around somewhere. He should find the provision that answers his questions. And that is the nature of revelation. Now, of course, there's lots of books that say this is a revelation. They make that claim. But again, you have to judge the authority. This book says it's from God. Read on. Does it sound like God or not? Okay? What's that now?
We are not atheists.
God has given us a guidance.
Yes, I agree. God has given us a guidance.
Where is the guidance, please?
I just told you. You're going to find it in some book somewhere that says this is a revelation from God.
Okay.
You figure it out as you go along, which ones are worth the title, which ones deserve to be called a revelation, and which ones don't. That's up to you to figure it out in your head.
Okay. Let me ask you one more question. The book. Let me say the Bible.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Are there any other questions, ladies and gentlemen? Unfortunately, we don't have time to accommodate more than one question from one person. Are there any other questions, please? Will you please take your seat, sir?
My question is very brief. I would like to ask Mr. Siddharth, from the Quran, from the Bible, I can give him at least 25 predictions made by different prophets over a long period, over 1600 years apart. And they were all fulfilled in connection with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ in 3 days. All those predictions. Is there any prediction made in the Quran which does not relate to the prophets of the Old Testament?
Thank you, sir. Mr. Didat?
Just to clarify the question, is there any prophecy of the Quran, you say, which does not relate to what? I lost you there, I'm sorry.
Which is not taken from the Old Testament.
Oh, is there any prophecy in the Quran that doesn't come from the Old Testament?
That's not taken from the Old Testament.
Yes, sure. If it depends on what you mean by prophecy. If you're talking about a prediction of something to happen, yes. You have, for example, one of those falsifiable statements, as I said. I believe he was quoting it when he talked. The Quran says to the Muslims, you will always find that those closest in love to you will be the Christians rather than the Jews. You see, today, that still stands, or it stood for 14 centuries to the Jews, telling them, you Jews want to prove Muslims are wrong here. The Quran tells you what to do. It says, treat us better than the Christians do, and we'll believe you. You see, it's told the Jew, all you have to do is start treating Muslims very nice. Let a few years go by, then say to the Muslims, doesn't your book say that Christians are better friends than we are? Look, we're better friends. But they never thought of it. That's a prophecy.
My question was for Mr. Sadat to answer.
Your question has been framed in such a roundabout way. You said that it's a very simple question. But if you will put it simply to me, it will make it easy for me to answer. Will you please repeat your question?
My question is, do you have any predictions in the Quran?
Right.
Any prophecy in the Quran?
In the Quran,
that
yes.
Was not
there are prophecies in the Quran. At the time of the Prophet ﷺ, when they were under trials and tribulations, when there seemed to be no hope, God Almighty gives the Holy Prophet Muhammad a hope that he is going to conquer. And they will be able to return to Makkah and perform their Hajj. Then there is a chapter in the Quran called Surah Rum. And in that surah, the incident that is referred to is that the Persians and the Romans, they were at war. And the Persians conquered the Romans. And in the Quran, they were told that within a small period of time, the Romans will once more again conquer the Persians. These are prophecies being fulfilled in the lifetime of the Prophet. And a standing prophecy about the supremacy of Islam over all the religions. You see, in the Holy Quran we are told He says, لِيُزَهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ, that the God Almighty has given Muhammad in Islam a religion, a way of life that is going to conquer, supersede every way of life, whether it be Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianism. And from the figure that I gave you at the beginning of my talk, where I said that there are 1,000 million Muslims in the world today, as against 1,200 million Christians. Numerically, people who fill census forms, 1,200 million. But if you take into account that Islam started 600 years after Christianity, you can see the obvious, that Islam is superseding every other way of life. And in the Plain Truth magazine of some few months back, there were figures given of the progress or the growth of each and every religion on earth, each and every philosophy. And in that, you'll find the highest percentage of progress was given to Islam, something like 267%, as against the Roman Catholics, as against the Hindus, as against the Jews, every system. So here is a prophecy that is being fulfilled all the time. I hope that answers your question.
I simply want to say that I agree with everything both speakers have said, except for your second speaker on one issue. Does he first of all agree with me that God created the universe as well as us?
Do you believe that God created the universe as well?
Yes, do you?
Mr. Miller.
Okay, so if I understand your question, you're saying, do I believe that God created the universe as well as us?
Yes, that's right. All living creatures on this planet as well.
Yes, of course.
You do.
I don't know if you, it depends on how you mean create. Somebody told me a story the other day that said when he made man, he rolled up his sleeves and he made man. No, I don't believe that.
No.
But well, create, however it happened, he created, yes.
However it happens, yes. I'm willing to go along with that.
Okay,
however he created it. The fact is, you agree that God created everything. Now, you said it was not possible. Look, I'm not talking for Christianity or anybody else. You said that Christ could not have been of virgin birth.
No, I didn't say that. Misunderstood. Okay. Be sure you misunderstood me. Then I didn't say that. No. What I said was. People, when they use this argument, when they say, who was his father, and they say God was his father, I ask them, do you mean God took Mary as wife? I'm not denying that he had, I'm saying he had no father. That's physically possible. Some biologists will tell you, you can do it today. You can make a child without a father. Like they do it with rabbit eggs, diploid, you put the, if they touch each other, they will reproduce. But that's,
yes,
it's possible, that's no problem.
Accidental impregnation, I agree with that.
Okay.
But tell me, if God himself chose to send or chose to come to this planet, to the people whom he created in the form of a human being, why do you think that he should have limitations in that he should not be able to do that?
No, I didn't say I didn't think he should be able to do that. What I'm pointing out to you was you have to clarify what you mean. If you say God became a human being, I still want to know what you mean. Do you mean he used to be God, but now he's a man, he's not God anymore, or do you mean something else, and so on? That a person, it's too easy to say God took on the form of a human being. I want to finish it for me. Did he surrender some of his physical powers? And they'll usually tell you yes. And then I say, did he surrender his mental powers? And they'll have to think about that and say, well, no, yes, maybe he did, I don't know, and so on. You have to clarify. What do you mean if you say God became a man? You have to really explain what you mean before I could possibly agree with you.
What you are looking for now is scientific proof.
No. I'm looking for an understanding of what someone means. It's like me asking you, is it colder in the winter than it is in Alaska? And you're going to say, what are you talking about? In the winter than Alaska? And so you got to clarify it. If you say, could God become a man? I'm saying, you explain to me what you mean, and I'll tell you whether I agree or not. You need a clear explanation of, do you mean he gave up everything godly, and so there's no God anymore, he's become a man, but somehow he will become God again? Or do you mean he is a man and he's God, in which case I want to know, then is he mortal or immortal? Does he know everything or not, and so on?
All right, to answer your questions, I'll just assume that God became a man and remained God. Why was that not possible?
Because
if he created the universe, why couldn't he do that?
because it is a logical mistake that people make when they say God can do anything. It's not true. God cannot do anything unless you believe he does stupid things.
No,
does he do foolish things? Does he do weak things? Does he do silly things? He is limited because he's God to doing godly things to start with. Now, if you tell me he is a man and he is God, I simply have a natural question. I'm saying, could they kill him or not? Is he mortal or immortal? God is immortal, man is mortal. Which was he if he's both, and so on? To say, if he is a man by definition has limitations. It's what makes him a man. He doesn't know everything. That's why he's a man. If God is a man, what is this being then? Does he know everything or only some things? If he knows only some things, he's a man. If he knows everything, he's God. You see, that's the problem. It's that you cannot combine the two, or so far no one's ever done it for my satisfaction. Combine the two.
You are simply using human logic.
Of course. Is there a better kind of logic?
Where
do I find it? On a quantity
that was capable of creating the entire universe, you are now applying human logic.
Okay. No. Is there another kind of logic? Where do I find it? Because if there's a better logic, you tell me where I can go find the textbook. I want to know about it.
Well, if you say in the one breath that he created the universe as well as everything that lives on this planet, you have to accept that anything is possible.
I just told you why God cannot do everything, because my God cannot do stupid things. So he has some limitations. He only does godly things.
I'm sorry, sir, but okay? Your definition of stupid
you,
and
Mr.
God's
Miller.
Definition won't
I? Thank you, sir. The next question, please.
I greet you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I will ask Mr. Miller a question. First of all, how much were you paid to come down here?
I think, Mr. Miller...
You must have come in late. I explained that.
No, you did explain that, but I feel that there's something fishy about it because you let yourself down.
As I told you, in Islam...
You said that nobody paid your fare.
That's right. That's right.
Seems like you are telling a lie.
Okay, but you see...
You're a liar.
If your religion...
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ,
if your religion,
you're a liar.
If your religion permits you to call a man a liar without proof, that's to your shame. My religion doesn't permit me to call a man a liar unless I bring the proof.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone who has a question to ask on the merits of the discussion, please pose your questions. You are excused, sir. The next person will now ask his question. I'm sorry, sir, you forfeited your right to ask a question. Will the next person please pose his question? Will you please remain silent, ladies and gentlemen? This is important. You will have an opportunity if there is time remaining. Will you please now allow the next person to ask the question? Is it a question on the merits of the discussion, or is it some defamatory statement which you intend to make? Yes. Please restrict yourself to the merits
right.
of the discussion.
Fine.
Yes. Go ahead and ask your question.
Mr. Miller, if I had to take an orange and in front of you peel this orange and slowly cut it into many pieces, and then I take this orange and I slowly eat this orange piece by piece, and eventually, when the orange has been eaten, and I ask you a question, Mr. Miller, how does that orange taste? What would you tell me? Go to the mic, please.
Is that the entire question?
That's right. You tell me, if you eat an orange,
yes,
and then you ask me how did it taste?
Yes. Yes. That's right.
I can tell you how most oranges taste, but I have no idea how the one tasted that you ate.
That's right. That's right, Mr. Miller. You haven't tasted Jesus Christ. You haven't experienced the power of the Holy Spirit. You haven't experienced the power of the Holy Spirit and the new birth in Jesus Christ.
Fine.
You
now,
cut
you,
me off.
Are you finished with your question? Or do you
want
to give another lecture? Because if you want to give a lecture, we'll come and hear you sometime. But you know, this was supposed to be a question period.
The mic on there.
You asked a question, I gave you an answer. Yeah, fine. You asked a question, I gave you my answer. If you say you have experienced the power of Jesus Christ, God bless you. That is your business, you see? You see? That is your business.
You haven't eaten the orange.
I understand. I'm not a child. I understand your point. I just said, if you have sampled this wonderful power and so on, that is your business. It's not something you can give me. God has to give it to me. Okay? So don't tell me you're gonna save me somehow, because if God gave you this thing, that's between you and God. Be my guest.
Thank you, sir. Next question.
Greetings, brothers and sisters, in the lovely name of Jesus Christ this evening. When I seen the advert in the newspaper concerning our friend Mr. Didat and Mr. Miller, I read about divinity being confirmed today in this auditorium, as it were. Sorry for being late. I've been busy at church services, but this is one thing that I would want to stress to Mr. Miller, that he has come to point out to people out here the meaning of divinity. And what he has actually finished off with on the stage doesn't confirm anything as far as divinity is concerned to me. And what I would want to leave with him is this, only just one thing. If he cannot believe that God can be doing everything at the same time, if I can operate three different jobs at the very same time, I can kick, I can punch, I can smile. I am human. My God can do much more than that, because he's divine. Thank you, my friend. God bless you.
Thank you. Do you have a question, sir?
I just want to ask one question to Mr. Didat. When you die, where are you going?
Mr. Didat.
Yes. Yes.
Mike, by the grace of God, I believe that we'll go in heaven, inshallah.
But now, is
the next questioner, please. Will you please take your seat, sir? The next person to the mic.
Mr. Miller, for the benefit of most of the Christian people here, I'd like to ask you a simple question. Are you a Christian or a Muslim?
Mr. Miller.
I thought I made that clear by what I was summing up by. You see, names like Jew, the meaning is one who praises God. Jew. I'm a Jew. I praise God. But I'm not capital J-E-W means I'm an Israeli citizen or something. Jew in the meaning. Christian is not a Christ-given name. Jesus never said, call yourselves Christian. That was a nickname that was given years after his time. But if by Christian you mean one who follows Christ, I am a Christian. In the same way, Muslim is not a label that means you're an Arab or something. Muslim means one who submits his will to God. I'm a Muslim, I submit my will to God. If you want to say your salvation belongs according to some label, I'm sure you don't, you're more sensible than that, I'm sure, but if you say your label belongs to something, you fall into this trap, as the Quran says, do they say they have a contract with God? So that their salvation happened at this time, never mind they lived for 40 more years, their salvation happened at this time, whereas I believe you struggle till the day you die. Any day, any given day, someone can say, what's your standing? If you were to die right now, are you ready to meet God? Yeah, I know whether I am or not. But I can't say, and a week from Tuesday, I am still saved. I don't know till a week from Tuesday, because I'm struggling and fighting with it until that day. That is a large difference between kinds of people who grab labels or say, I have my salvation already, and other people who are not so quick with the labels and say, my salvation, I'm working on it, I'm going to work on it till the day I die.
In other words, you are a Muslim.
Happy to be a Muslim, yes, happy to be a Muslim, thank God.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Great answer.
Yes, sir, your question.
My question is this. When I'm asking a question, please don't put the mic off, because this is what you did in the city hall. If you want to answer a question, you answer it full.
Sir,
first, I want to tell you, praise the Lord, before I start my question. Hallelujah, glory to his name. What I want to ask you is this. It has been mentioned from the platform that all are born Muslims. I want you to prove that I'm a born Muslim.
No problem. If you can understand what I mean by Muslim, the demonstration is there. You could study it, and there's more books on the subject than you could read. Now, do you want the answer or not? My wife can prove it to you.
I am not a born Muslim.
Do you want proof or not? You asked me for proof. Do you want proof or not? Do you want proof or not? You asked me for proof. Now, as soon as I open my mouth, you tell me I'm not. If you want proof, I'll give it to you if you be quiet. The proof is what you will find if you investigate what do people believe if no one comes and tells them what to believe. If you want to read the documentation of cases of people like the Kapauku tribe of Papua who never met civilized man till the 1920s, if you want to read the documentation of what did the Aborigines of Australia believe before the white man came there, and so on, if you want to read the documented belief, what did they believe before someone came and told them what to believe, you will find it is Islam in everything but name. Because they don't speak Arabic, they don't say Islam, their religion is the same. God is one, he has no sons, he's not subject to aging, and so on and so on and so on. The proof is there.
Well, all right, I will answer you for that. Can I answer him?
No, I'm afraid you can't, sir. Are there any others? Sir, there is a limited time. There is a limited time. Are there any other questions? It is the prerogative of anyone who wants to express their opinion to invite either of the speakers to a debate and then to exercise their rights to express their opinions. You are now availed of the opportunity of asking questions on the basis of the discussions presented. If people do not persist in jeering, laughing, joking, wasting time basically at the mic, I think fruitful and important questions will be passed through from which people can learn. Ladies and gentlemen, this is an assembly of God. We are discussing divine issues, important issues, intrinsic to our lives. Those who persist in jeering and laughing are, to say the least, absolutely unstable. Will you please ask your question, sir?
I have a few questions, just about three questions, but don't switch the mic off.
Unfortunately, sir, we have only 5 minutes.
Three questions in 1 minute.
Yes, please proceed.
Maybe less than a minute. A person came up here and said to Ahmad Didat, "I'll show that you are going to heaven." Ahmad Didat said, "The grace, by the grace of God." But the Bible tells me, by the grace of God, I can live a holy life. But the blood of Jesus can take me to heaven. Thank you.
Do you want Mr. Didat to comment on that?
Yes, Ahmad Didat said, by the grace of God, he can go to heaven. Now I want to know how the grace of God can take him to heaven.
Yes, sir, Mr. Didat. The question is, how can the grace of God transport a person to heaven?
You know, this cocksureness that you are displaying and the display of your fellow cultists there, you know, it amazes me that the Christian, they were dragging their feet to get to the mic in the first instance. It's one by one, you're getting the courage to come along and waste our time. You're making statements and you want an answer. I am humble. I'm not as arrogant, as cocksure as the Jews were in the time of Jesus. You have the privilege of being as arrogant as you like. I am humble. I believe in the grace of God, and on that strength, I have hope that by God willing, I shall enter the good pleasures of God. Did I condemn you? No, that is you condemning yourself. The way, the arrogant stand in which you are standing now, and your fellow Christians there in that corner, ready to run away, look at them. Is this the way, you know, cultured people and Christians behave? Look at this. Look at the behavior. It's an absolute disgrace on born-again Christians. Yes, my friend, if you have a question, please ask your question, because yours will be the last question.
Thank you, Mr. Didat. We have just 3 minutes left, ladies and gentlemen. Sufficient time for just one more question.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm a bit intrigued about things I hear this evening, or this afternoon, rather. But I must certainly confess very truly that what I hear is in fact the truth, whether it's from the Christian side or the Islamic side. But what I would like to get clarification on is it possible for God to turn into a man, physical blood, bones and blood vessels, etc., perfect human being, died 2,000 years ago for my sins 2,000 years later? I seem that highly illogical. If I could get a reasonable explanation, how is this possible?
Do you direct the question to Mr. Miller, sir, or Mr. Didat?
Well, listening to both the speakers, they've been telling the truth, so either one can take the liberty.
Mr. Miller, will you please answer? And this will be the last answer, ladies and gentlemen. We don't have more time for any further questions.
You're asking me, is it possible God can become a man, die for my sins, and I can still benefit 2,000 years later? You're asking the wrong person. I mean, ask a Christian. That's what he believes. I have reason not to, you see. So I can't really defend that idea because I don't believe it, okay? I don't believe that someone died for my sins. It becomes a hypothetical question. It's like people saying, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin? I don't know. I'm not going to worry myself over it, you see. Since I don't believe somebody died for my sins, I'm not going to try and defend the belief of those who do. They may have their defense, and believe me, I've heard them all, and they haven't convinced me yet. So how can I offer you something, you see?
Thank you. We have, fortunately, just 1 minute. I think we'll entertain just one more question.
Can we have sound? Okay. Mr. Miller, many Christians have attended this meeting under the impression that this was going to be a normal type of symposium organized by the IPC, where you have a Christian who puts forth his point of view and then Mr. Didat puts forth the Islamic point of view. Now, I'm sure after your speech, more Christians are as confused as ever. For the sake of clarity, could you tell us clearly, without perambulating, as to whether you are a Christian or a Muslim? By Christian, I mean one who recognizes the lordship of Jesus over his life, or a Muslim who does not recognize Jesus as Lord, but as one of the prophets, and as a practicing Muslim who follows all the
You may as well ask me, will I stop beating my wife, yes or no?
What I want to know is, how do you know I'm married? You see, or a Muslim?
You said, are you a Christian, meaning you acknowledge Jesus as Lord, or are you a Muslim and you don't acknowledge Jesus as Lord? Jesus is Lord, and I'm a Muslim saying that. He's Lord, and so is, according to the Bible, Abraham. It says Sarah, because she was a good wife, called her husband Lord. Whatever you mean by Lord may be something else, but I don't hesitate to call him Lord. If you mean master, teacher, and so on, yes, he was, by all means. By Lord, I guess you mean God in the flesh and so on, and still I've tried to tell you, you have to tell me what you mean by that. If you mean, was Jesus God, as many Christians are now saying, they say, Jesus is God. When you ask them, what do you mean? They say, he was God's chief spokesman. If you spit in Jesus' face, it's the same as spitting in God's face. I agree with that. No problem. You can, if that's the sense you mean, he's God's chief representative. Jesus said, who honors me, honors God, no problem. But if you mean, I don't know what you mean. Do you mean his fingernails? They were divine when he cut them and he buried them? They were pieces of God? I don't know. What do you mean? You see? He's saying the way do you acknowledge Jesus as Lord of your life. Any prophet is Lord of my life in that if I find out this is something he used to do, then, and he offered it as a command that I should do it, then I will do it. I don't know of anything I'm doing that, or not doing, that Jesus said I should do. Okay?
I think that's bigger the turn your feet are saying.
Whatever.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. All right, you've just beaten the band. Just one more question.
Do you have anything here? Thank you very much. I greet one of you, everyone here this evening, in the precious Lord of the precious name of our Lord and Savior. Well, I must say that I enjoyed the discussion. We know that we are confronted here today by a Christian denomination and a Muslim. But us as human beings, I would like to also put a question forward. We know that, Mr. Didat, Mr. Miller, that we know that our lifespan has got to end. We know that after this life on earth, we've got to go somewhere else. We do believe that. But now, Mr. Didat, I would like to know, from my belief, which says that except a man be born again, he cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Now, I don't want to just live here on earth and then die and my life is finished. We believe in our soul, where it's going to enter. I would like you to explain on that day, Mr. Didat, on those terms. Except a man be born again, he cannot inherit the kingdom of God. We believe that the same God has created you has created me. So I would like to know my escape, my choice as a sinner.
Fine. If you're saying, am I born again? You see, the words born again are in the Bible. It's a mistranslation. You know that as well as I do. The words in the Greek say generated from above. Now, if you call that born again, that's fine. That right. It's close enough. Literally,
just relax, sorry, just relax. Let's take it slowly.
Literally, it says in the original text, as yes. some Bibles translated, yeah. unless a man be generated from above. Yeah. Now, some people write, born again.
Yeah.
The real meaning, generated from above. I am generated from above, I believe, because I didn't know what to do, then God showed me what to do. So I was born again, I was generated from above. All right.
Sir, thank you, sir. Does that now, does that distinguish between a sinner man and a righteous man?
Of course. One man is off into the road to destruction and the other man is going on the straight path.
Yes, sir. And on his own accord, can that born again experience be possible?
You're asking, it comes from God. How can it be on your own accord?
Amen. Praise the Lord. So that's what I say. If we believe in God, we shall inherit the kingdom of God.
Yes.
But there's only one way we can go through God, isn't it, sir?
Yes, of course. But
through
it's
Jesus.
Just what a person should worry about is that it's yes, reported sir. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, yes. many people will come to me on that day and say, Master, we used to do wonderful things in your yes. name. And he said, I will tell them, get away from me, I never knew you. Now,
that's a hypocrite.
Yes, that's yes, it. Sure. But these people are saying, you know, we did wonderful things. So what that's I'm right, saying is sir. Everyone who says he's born again, that's not a magic ticket. He
that's
may
right.
not know what he's talking about.
That's right. So
we agree.
Now, yes, sir. I would like to just enclose.
Thank you, sir. The mic, please, gentlemen.
Like Mr. Didat, as we know, we might have been on different denominations, but let's face it, the most important thing is that, as we know, that your aim is to win us people to the Muslim faith, just like the Christian wants to win people, because we believe that we have one aim, isn't it, sir, to inherit the kingdom of God?
Mr. Didat.
The belief is there, but we can suffer from hallucinations. You see, people thinking that they are on the right track, they are actually disobeying the laws and commandments of God. Instead of worshipping God, they're worshipping a created being, a creature born in the stable to a Jewish girl. Now you say, he is your God. So for that, we say that you are going to go to hell. There is no way out for you because you are now conferring divinity upon a human being, and this human being never claimed to be God. You see, this human being was born in the stable 2,000 years ago. In the stable, he was circumcised on the eighth day. He used to drink milk from his mother's breast. He used to wet his napkins. I don't know, but I can see you. Look, you have been agreeing with the speaker all along. I was watching you. You were agreeing all along. But somehow at the back of the mind, there is another type of, you know, cultivation, which is making you to think that you have got the right road, but you are, my child, on the wrong road. You see, Jesus Christ never said he's God, nowhere. Nor did he say, worship me anywhere. So if you have a church, you know, if you have a church, your minister, your padre, your bishop, ask him to organize a meeting and we will come and listen to him. You see, on all these things that you're talking, and then we will question them. And I assure you, your bishop or your pope will get cold feet and he'll never allow anybody to question them. There are Christian missionaries here. They're going to deliver lectures, but they haven't got that courage of their conviction to allow the Muslims to question them. They want to push things down people's throats. Look, this we haven't done to you. We have given you a very fair opportunity, as you will acknowledge, but people have been dragging their feet to the mic. That you will also agree. Look, you should have been the first man. Look, people have been dragging their feet. So, look, you were there. People from the outside, they had been coming in, but it took you so long to come, you are the last man. May God bless you. But now look, what you do, arrange a meeting, or a dialogue, or a discussion, or a debate. Go ahead and arrange it, and we will come and meet you on your ground.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, no time remains for questions. Thank you very much for attending. I'm sure we've all been enriched by our attendance here this evening. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I will be very strict. I'll ask them to sit down. We want questions on the subject matter that has been spoken tonight. by both our learned lecturers. Please use this mic, come forward, put your question and sit down, and please let us know to whom the question is directed, either to Brother Gary Miller or to Brother Ahmad Didat, and then they will answer your questions. Thank you very much.
Now, I recall that on that show, you had said that you don't want to hear what Paul said or the apostles said, and you had then said on the show that Jesus was not the Son of God. Now, I would like to hear your comment on two portions of Scripture where Jesus was speaking. He asked his apostles, his disciples, who do men say that I the Son of Man, am? And then he says, and who does the you say that I am? So Peter stood up and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus said to him, flesh and blood does not reveal that to you, but my Father which art in heaven. That is the one portion. The other portion is on the question whether God is one. For the Christian concept of that versus the Muslim concept. Jesus was asked, what is the most important commandment? And then he answered. He said, the Lord your God is one, and you must love the Lord with all your heart and so on. And then he saw further to the heart of the man who was asking him the question. And then he asked him a question. He said, who the Christ be? Whose son would he be? And then they said, well, the son of David. So he said, but how is it then that he is to be the son of David? That in the Psalms, David called him Lord when he said, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I've made your enemies. And of course we get that from Psalm 2, where we see that the Lord says to his son, sit at my right hand, and so on. If you could just answer that, please. That was to Mr. Didat, yes.
And Didat, yes. It was to me.
That's to you.
Now, the reason why I have to make doubly sure was because the references that were made by Brother Gary Miller, I had not spoken about the sonship and all that. They were other maybe
the names, thinking that his name is Didat and I'm Gary Miller. That was the reason. This guy.
Right.
Or you now, this expression made by Peter, when Jesus asked, he said, who do you think I am? He said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now, this expression, Son of God, what does it mean? You see, this is not the time to debate, but I will give you an explanation since it's a question. Otherwise, I'm going to ask you and we're going to lengthen this meeting and we won't finish even until 12. Son of God, what did it mean to the Jew? Did it mean that God begot a son? How many sons does God have? We are asking our Christian brethren, how many sons has he got? And you'll get the answer, one. I says, it's unfortunate you don't know your Bible. See, God, in the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 3, you read there the genealogy of Jesus, and it says, and Adam, the son of God. So was Adam the son of God? He must be. Then Jesus Christ, he said, says, all the good people, as many as are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Means every Tom, Dick, and Harry, if you follow the will and plan of God, he is a godly person. In the language of the Jew, he is a son of God. Then you read from the book of Genesis, chapter 6, verse 3, it says, and the sons of God, sons von Hot. And the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them to wife all that they chose. How many did he have? Many. And when the sons of God, chapter 6, came in unto the daughters of men and bore children to them, they became great men of old, men of renown. How many sons did he have? Many. In the book of Exodus, God says, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. In the book of Jeremiah, he said, Ephraim is my son, even my firstborn. In the book of Psalms, God speaks to David. He said, I will declare a decree unto thee that thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. So in the language of the Jew, in the idiom of the Jew, it means nothing more than a goodly person. As far as the Messiah is concerned, we say he was a Messiah, and Messiah doesn't mean God, because God had Messiahs also by the tons in the Bible. You find this word Messiah in Hebrew, you apply for Cyrus, a pagan. In the book of Isaiah, God says, it is I who have surnamed thee, that though thou hast not known me, means you, a pagan, a mushrik, although you don't know me, I still call you Messiah. But the Christians have translated the word Messiah to anointed. See, wherever it suits them, they retain the word Messiah as Messiah. Whenever it suits them, they translate it as Christ. And whenever it suits them, they translate it as anointed. And you'll find this word Messiah applied to pots and pans and horns and everything. It's here in this book of mine, Christ in Islam. If you like, you can check it up. Dozens of places in the Bible where anything and everything is described as Christ, Messiah. But in your translations, the translators have deceived the people by changing, instead of retaining the word Messiah as Messiah, they would put the word anointed. So you think it's something else. But in the original, it's Messiah. In the Greek, it is Christos. What was the second question?
Psalms,
yes. Now, this prophecy, if it is applied to Jesus, before he was born, this prophecy was made, that come, I will make you to sit on my right hand and make your enemies your footstool. Look, it never happened. Who are his enemies? Who are the enemies of Jesus? Anybody will tell you, the Jews. And they are strutting around in the Middle East, giving endless trouble to my people. They're making the American dog to wag, you know, the tail. Israel is the tail and America is the dog. And whichever the tail wants, the American dog wags, moves around. It's a mighty power. 6 million Jews are dictating what to do in the Middle East. That enemy of Jesus, look, where are they? Where is Jesus? Sitting on the right hand of God. Doing what? Waiting. For what? To make his enemy's footstool. 2,000 years. You get a hot pant, you know, you sit down one place. I'm sure some people sitting there now getting hot pants already. 2,000 years the poor man is sitting and waiting. For what? His enemies to be made his footstool. I said, look, it doesn't apply to Jesus. It doesn't, can't. Otherwise, it's a very pitiful sight. You agree, 2,000 years a man is waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool, and they're still strutting around in the world. Pitiful.
That gentleman over there.
I'm so busy asking questions because, in fact, I have two questions to ask Mr. Didak. Number one, Mr. Didak, is that you did mention that the Quran is the only book that is unadopted and unchanged. Now, as a Christian, I believe that that's not the case, but I want you to prove me wrong. Since Muslims or Islam refutes some of the basic doctrines of Christianity, which also means that basically it rejects what the Bible teaches, present-day Bible, I would like to ask this question, however. If then what you're saying between the lines is true, that the Bible has been changed, I would like to know when and where, and also, I would like also to make mention of this fact, that Mr. Muller mentioned it and quoted from the Quran, that the Quran is sent to confirm that which came before it, but note, it says also to safeguard those scriptures that came before it. Now, if then the Quran is there to confirm and safeguard the Bible or the Christian and Jewish scripture that came before it, if the Bible has been changed, it means that the Quran has failed in its duty to safeguard those scriptures.
You see, the Holy Quran confirms that Jesus is the Christ. Something worth confirming, because the Jews, they insinuated that Jesus Christ, because he had no earthly father, he was the illegitimate child of Mary. So either the Muslim must accept that, or accept what the Christian said, that his father is God. So the Quran comes to rectify the misconception that the Christian has, that because he has no earthly father, his father is God. So it says, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, O people of the book, La taghlu fi dinakum. Do not go to extremes in your religion. Don't go to extremes, you Jews and Christians. You Jews are going to one extreme and the Christians are going to another extreme. Don't go to extremes. وَلَا تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ. And don't say anything about God except the truth. And what the truth is? إِنَّمَا الْمَسِيحِ. Most certainly the Messiah. Isa ibn Maryama, Jesus the son of Mary, Rasulullah, is the messenger of God. So it confirms. It rectifies you wherever you made false, wherever you made your interpolations. Your Trinity is a fabrication, it says so. That Jesus is the begotten Son of God, it says so. You see, it rectifies your mistakes and it tells you, as our brother pointed out, that it is a check on what the Christians and the Jews are teaching. So this is the book of God. It is confirming what is with you, what is true. If you say that God is one, it confirms. If you say adultery is evil, it confirms. That stealing is bad, it confirms. Taking of life, killing people is bad, it confirms. So whatever is right, it confirms. And then wherever you have made mistakes, it corrects you, and then it replaces with the right answer.
Mr. Zidar, I believe that you did not answer my question, because my question was this. I'm not asking what you believe with regards to those things that the Bible agrees with the Quran in. I am talking about those things which the Quran disagrees as far as the Bible is concerned, which ultimately means that the Muslims disagree with the Bible as well. Now, excuse me, that means if it is alleged that the Quran, all right, the confirmation you have to some length explained, but if the Quran is there to safeguard the Bible, then such discrepancies should not be found.
The Quran doesn't say anywhere that it is going to safeguard the Bible, because there was no such thing as the Bible. See, the first place you have a Bible is the one that you have. If you have one, you see, if I ask you which Bible are you talking about,
I want to know which Bible are you talking about, because there are dozens and dozens of Bibles. Different versions. Which one are you talking about? You see, the Roman Catholics, they have what is called the Douay version of the Bible. You know about that, right? And that Bible has 73 books. 73 books. Now, must I accept that one or accept yours? Yours has got 66. You are a Protestant, I take it. Silence. You are a Protestant, I take it.
Please.
Unless you are a Roman Catholic. Are you a Roman Catholic?
I wouldn't want to answer that.
I know why. Because now you see, this is the trick that the Christian plays on you. When you want to know where do you belong, are you fish or fowl? And the man won't tell you. See, because as soon as you say that you belong to a certain denomination, I say your denomination was a partner in this Bible, which went on to say that the King James Version has great defects. If you say that you belong to a certain church, I said, look, that church of yours backed this Bible up, which threw out the ascension of Jesus, thrown out, Trinity thrown out, begotten Son thrown out. Can you see? So I said, your church was involved. So the easy way out is, I don't own up where I belong. I don't want to say what church I belong to. So it's an easy way out. So you can take any impossible stand, and the man can say nothing to you. Please, give somebody else a chance. Next question.
Next.
And if you want to ask another question, go at the back.
That lady over there.
Lost my country in 10 years today, but I just want to say I'm not going to my heart going for the Lord. It's my love for Jesus Christ. It's not a car that I'm going. And I want to thank the Lord that I could have been here tonight. You know, no, I'm going to make this speech. We're not here to debate on God's word. We're not here to debate on God's word. Can I just
verse from Proverbs 16. Okay, now let me ask you the question then, if you want to hear the verse. In Genesis chapter 16, verse 12, I want to ask Mr. Dieter the question, and he will be a wild man, Genesis 16, verse 12. That's from Ishmael, Mr. Dieter. And he will be a wild man, his hand will be against every man, and every man's hand against him, and he shall dwell in the presence of all his brethren. Now, that's the verse, Mr. Dieter, and that's concerning Ishmael, and the covenant that God has given, the everlasting covenant with Isaac, and the promise to Ishmael of just the great nations. Could you explain that?
You see, the right thing for me to do was to ask you for an explanation about the verses that you have quoted, which means now you will go into delivering a lecture. You see, what had Ishmael and Isaac to do with Islam and Christianity that we were discussing tonight?
Well,
beg your pardon?
Yes.
No, no, but now, what has that sacrifice to do with Islam and Christianity tonight? I beg your pardon?
About
what? You must tell me now, what did I mock? You see, you're not asking the question, you're creating some new subject now about Ishmael and Isaac. Now, who was offered for sacrifice? Was it Ishmael or Isaac? I tell you, according to the Bible, that is not true. Because you read there, Isaac, thy only son. And at no time was Isaac the only son of Abraham. You see, 13 years before Isaac was born, Ishmael was born. And God Almighty accepted him as the son and seed of Abraham. No less than 12 places in the book of Genesis, God speaks about Ishmael. He said, as for Ishmael, I have heard thee. 12 princes shall he beget, and I will make him a great nation, because he is thy son. Because, another place, he is thy seed. No less than 12 places. God Almighty accepts Ishmael as a son and seed of Abraham long before Isaac was born. 13 years before Isaac was born. So now, when was Isaac the only son and seed of Abraham? You go and work that out, and next time when I come to Johannesburg, you tell me.
This question again is for Mr. Dieter. Now, before I actually ask the question, I would just like to say something as I see. Then my statement will be part of my question. Okay. It is such that both Muslim and Christian believe that God is a just God. Right?
What is that?
That God is a just God. What is a fair God?
What is just?
Right. Both Muslims and Christians believed the fact that God is a God of love. Right? Okay, but I'm going to say, okay, we go for that. It's too much. It's too much. And if God be a loving God, how in Islam does God atone for sins, man, like in Christianity, when Jesus died and fulfilled the just requirements of God in punishing sin, and also where God could say to the Christian, I can forgive you because Jesus Christ died. How in Islam is there atonement?
You see?
and there was no crucifixion. Number two, that he was not God. Number three, that God did not kill an innocent man for your sins, because this is the most unjust thing to do. Can you imagine? You go and commit all the crimes in the world, and we catch the most innocent man that we can find and hang him. You think God Almighty is such a being that for Adam's sin, Adam and Eve, they ate the fruit, and now he's going to put everybody into hell, and he's going to take his own son, an innocent child who had done no wrong, and have him hanged, and his poor man doesn't want to die, he's crying, sweating blood, and you know, never mind, hook or by crook, get him hanged. Is that God? Is that a loving God? You are a loving father to your child, I take it, if you have any children. And for somebody coming along, committing a crime in your house, you go and kill your child for somebody else's crime? Is that what you do? Because you love this criminal so much, all these sinners. Next man. Next man.
Mr. Chairman, as a confirmed atheist, am I allowed to ask two questions, sir? Where distinguished people in the long line of size or discipline or whatever we have to say. Why is it? Is it possible, or is it anywhere in the Bible or Quran, that Muhammad is the last one? There will be no further disciples or messiahs thereafter. I don't know if I've interpreted this evening's discussion correctly. But that is my assumption.
Right. The question was that he is a confirmed atheist. That's what he said. Did he say that? Yeah. Which means he doesn't believe in God. Now he wants to know where in the Quran or the Bible it is said that Muhammad is the last prophet. But look, it is not a book of authority for you. Where does it fit you to know? If you believe either of these books as the word of God, then you have a right to ask whether there is anything in the book, because there is something in the book. You see, in the Holy Quran, we are told, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ, that Muhammad is no more than a messenger. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِ الرُّسُلُ, it says many were the messengers that passed away before him. And it says, Muhammad is the خَاتُمُ النَّبِيِّينَ, he is the last and seal of the prophets. There shall be no prophets after him. The Quran says so. But now I don't know how that act can act as an authority for you when you say you don't even believe in God. I can't see any relevance unless you are playing a game with us to say you are a confirmed atheist. You just want to put us to the test whether we know our books, we know our onions or not. Right, I think we have answered it. And you young man, look, we were... All right, the next one. Let's have the next one. Right, next one, yes.
Muhammad and Christ, looking at the realities of civilization and of people, if the difference was very minute in terms of religious philosophy, and I think you have stated categorically that on all else we agree, why can't Christians and Muslims get together, set aside that minute difference, rather confuse our little minds? Why confuse our little minds? Why can't they preach that small difference? Take the 90% of compatibility and explore it and teach us the basic ingredient of godliness. Thank you.
Very good job in fishing in troubled waters. You see, this problem you should pose to the Christians, because the Muslim has given his hand. Look, he says Jesus is the Christ. The Muslim says that. The Muslim says that he was the Messiah. He says he was born miraculously, that he gave life to the dead by God's permission. He healed those born blind and the lepers. Look, the Muslim is giving his hand of friendship again and again and again. Now, this question of yours, this good spirit of yours, you should expend it on your Christian friends. Ask them that, look, since a Muslim is coming forward, why aren't you prepared to give your hand of acceptance and say, look, we also believe that Muhammad is the messenger of God, and you 1,200 million Christians and 1,000 million Muslims can get together on a common platform. Now, do that service for mankind. Ask your Christian friends.
Close the meeting now. You can't carry on like this.
Oh, I see, right. Now,
you also believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and you also...
No, we don't believe that.
Okay. Mr. Nidat, just give me a hearing. You people are suggesting you don't answer our questions properly, and I want an answer from you. You say that Christ didn't die for your sins, the Muslims, right? Am I right? You Muslims say that Jesus Christ didn't came to die for your sins. Well, we Christians believe that Jesus Christ died for our sins. Indeed, Jesus Christ died for our sins. We Christians.
Aren't you guilty of somebody else dying for your sins?
No, I'm not guilty.
That is the one thing that they are bad. He was to kill me, and
I don't want to listen to what that man is.
And these gentlemen, these missionaries, they will not come to ask questions. You know why? Because he said to Reverend James Cunningham that this is scum and we will not join scum. These born-again Christians. Ask him. Mr. Gilchrist there at the back, ask him what he calls you. Why isn't he coming forward to ask questions? Those missionaries there, why aren't they coming? Why are they putting you forward? What for? They want to make a fool of you. Look, they want to make a fool of you and get away with it. They will not listen to me. Listen to me. Look, if you have your bishop or priest of your church, if you have any, you go and arrange a meeting. Please, please. You were in the first place, you were not supposed to come to that bike. You remember? He said, look, you were already disqualified, and we, in act of charity, we gave you an opportunity, and you are taking unfair advantage. Please. If you have any church hierarchy, anybody of your church who's prepared to debate any subject, look, go and get your priests, go and get your missionaries to hire these halls like this and call us, and we are prepared to debate with you.
Right, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, the time is up.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar! Allah.